Hallelujah. Karana la manje gaya la la basia brava bahaya da. Kamamara di shahala. Aya brava. Zotu rebebeki rababoya. Sopra babeki shalala la baproboya. Sopra babeki shababalo lo lo. Sopra babeyo lo bo. Sopra babeni gaya la mona. Shout the shout. Hallelujah. Shout the shout of the redeemed. Come shout the shout. Come shout the shout of the redeemed. Come shout the shout. Come praise ye the Lord, all ye children of the Lord. Come bless the Lord. Come bless him. Come lift up your hands in the holy place. Come bless him now. Come give him praise. Come bless him now. Come bless him now. Come praise ye the Lord. Praise ye, praise ye, praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord.
I believe that if there's anything that the powers of darkness will fight against, you cannot hear me? You need to turn them up so that she can hear up here. I believe that if there's anything, can everybody else hear me? Might as well not be talking if I can't be heard. I believe that if there's anything that Satan would try to fight against, that the powers of darkness would try to fight against. Can you hear me now? Boy, that's a lot of echo in that one, ain't it? If there's anything Satan would try to fight against, it's praise and thanksgiving. I believe that's why God said that this is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus, that in all things you give thanks. If I could get people just to obey that one command of God, if I could get people to just to find their life and identity in just that one single thing, I could be a part of seeing those who would do that step into all the fullness of divine power and glory. Yeah, you begin to go everywhere doing the works of Jesus. Hallelujah. You begin to go everywhere, shining his lights in the midst of a crooked world. And here tonight, I'm telling you, there's one thing that is so dear to me. There's something, one thing so important to me. It's going to last forever. It's worshiping the King. I want to teach you how to praise him. I want to teach you how to sing your own song. And I want to teach you how to worship in spirit and in truth. I want you to follow me into a realm of thanksgiving where you leave all your stuff behind. It'll break off the pains of fear. It'll break off the pains of sickness. It'll break off the pains of disease, where you leave everything behind and you begin to be captivated by him. You don't even need an overhead. You don't even need to know the words. He put his words in your spirit, in your heart, written them upon the tables of your life by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Ha!
Begins to flow up out of the belly of those who praise him. Begins to flow up out of the belly of those who know him. Begins to flow up out of the belly of everyone who's blown by the wind of the Holy Ghost, moved by the wind of the Spirit, moved by the wind of the Lord, burning with the fire of his presence, burning with the fire of his grace. Be filled, be filled, be filled, be filled, be filled, be filled right now with his glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. With his glory. With the glory of the Lord, his glory's in this place. With the glory of the Lord, his glory's in this place. Be filled right now. Be filled right now. Be filled right now. Be filled right now.
be filled right now. Let me say this. Don't let the rocks do your job. Don't let the rocks do your job. Lift your hands and begin to give thanks. Just lift your hands and begin to give thanks. Yeah, begin to give thanks. Mama Nanjekaya. Begin to give thanks. Just lift your hands and begin to give thanks. Mama mana mana nana nana. Zerre mama mama nana la la mangeya. Zerre mama 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 nana nana. Hallelujah, hallelujah. It doesn't take long for the Holy Ghost to take over. Once you begin to praise Him, it doesn't take long. The Holy Ghost will take over. And out of your belly will flow rivers of prophecy. Out of your belly will flow, out of your innermost being, out of the sound of your voice will flow out the sound of God Almighty. The sound of His voice, the sound of His presence. The sound that makes glad the city of God will begin to bubble right up out of your belly. Begin to flow like rivers of living water. Just begin to give Him thanks. Just tell Him how wonderful He is for having redeemed you, for having saved you, for having delivered you from the pains of darkness, from the pains of sin. There's no reason tonight for anybody in this place to have sickness in their spirit, sickness in their body, sickness in their mind. There's no reason for anyone to be diseased in any way. There's no reason for anybody to be lacking in anything that belongs to the realms of heaven. There's no reason for anybody to be lacking in the sound of His words issuing forth from your life. Somebody said, I want that. Well, then you begin to give thanks. You begin to just worship Him with what you have and what you know. With all of your heart, you begin to just pour out your soul unto Him. And what's going to happen is the Holy Ghost is going to come and do the rest. He's going to take you to a higher ground, a higher place than you've ever known. As you just thank Him and praise Him for His goodness and for His wonderful works. To us, the children of men, I praise You, Lord. I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord.
I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord.
I praise you, Lord.
I
praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you for the fire of the Holy Ghost. Thank you for your fire, the fire of your presence. Thank you for your glory, the glory of your presence. Thank you for the wonders. The wonders of your presence, a close encounter, an overshadowing, a close encounter, an overshadowing, close encounter with the presence of the Lord, an overshadowing tonight. Overshadowing in your life tonight, and overshadowing of the mighty outpouring of His presence in your life, His glory and His fire, His power and His love, His glory and His fire, His power and His love, and overshadowing, close encounter with the presence of God, a close encounter, no more religion, but with the presence of God, an overshadowing, a touch from His grace, a great outpouring shores right here in this place, a close encounter with the presence of the Lord, the overshadowing with the presence of His grace, oh, and overshadowing with the fire of the Lord, the fire and His glory, the presence of the Lord, la di cararasia Abraham, zata rebebi gato son, garebe pribaba prabarai. An overshadowing, an encounter with the Lord.
overshadowing. A face-to-face encounter with the Lord.
Just lift your hands towards heaven. In the name of Jesus.
In Jesus' name. In the name of the living God. Begin to give him thanks. Begin to praise the Lord. Begin to give him thanks. Begin to praise his holy name. Let every yoke be broken. Let the bonds of sin be removed. Let everything that would hinder you be taken out of the way. You might praise him. I love you, Lord. And I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul. Rejoice, take joy, my King, in what you hear. Let me be a sweet sound in your ears. These tongues you gave, or this unction of your grace, let it pour forth through my life to you, like rivers from on high. Kermanjeti shotu rabaya la basia rabaya la ku. Doromonje debe kishare be privato suno. Dere be privala be subavala de vulabo. Japrima mando. Hallelujah. Oh, I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh, my soul. Rejoice, take joy, my King, in what you hear. Let me be a sweet, sweet sound in your ears. And I shall forever live to worship you, Lord.
And I shall forever live to sing your praise. Oh, and I shall forever live to worship you, oh, Lord. Forever sustained. Forever sustained by your grace. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You can be seated for a little while. Pray that there be, pray tonight there'd be great outburst of heaven in your soul. I pray there'd be great outburst of the power and the glory of God in your life tonight. That's what Father's purpose. I know that your culture didn't teach you these things, and I know that you've been trained to be still and be quiet and fit in. God wants to fill you up. Hallelujah. And make you stand out like the bright shining of a light. Hallelujah. God doesn't want you to fit in. Amen. He wants you to be raptured up into heaven's glorious realm. You know, I was so blessed today. My granddaughter was wishing us Father's Day in the way that she knows how. So she sang us about three songs, you know. And so what she does is she'll close her eyes and she'll begin to lift her hands and she'll put a little hand on her belly like this. And I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. And, well, where'd she learn how to do that? She was watching her papa, me, her dad, and her mom. People become very distraught about the things that they have to encounter in the world about them, and what are they going to do about all these other influences. I'll tell you right now, if you become a bigger influence in your children's life and in your family's life, you won't have to worry about other influences, you know. You become a bigger influence around those people that you are allowed to rub shoulders with. I mean, when they can begin to see heaven in your life. This is what Father's purpose. And dear people, it's just going to begin by you learning how to lift your hands and, you know, hey, look, she's only 3 years old. My goodness gracious, this is not very difficult. It's probably easier for a three-year-old because life is not as complicated as older people make it. Actually, life isn't complicated. It's a deception. It's the cares of this life. It's the things that people choose that causes them all of the problems and all of the issues and all the pain and all the sorrow. And then, of course, you know, folks always have a, you know, kick back on that, say, no, you don't understand the woman I have to live with or the man I have to live with or the job that I have to go to or our living condition or the bills that I owe or on and on it goes, the tax man, the other man, and I don't have a man and, you know, whatever. And I do hear a lot of I don't have a man, and it's not the man, you know, at the pool waiting for the moving of the water either. It's a woman who's still waiting for her husband. Listen, whatever the problem is, whatever the issues are, if you could find this place of relationship with Jesus, hallelujah. Because if you want it to be greater, if you want the influence and the impacts of heaven to be more extreme and more exciting and more real, then you're going to have to give yourself to those interactions. Hallelujah. You know, if all you ever give yourself is to the interactions of, you know, how to sing the song and you know the words and it's just a dry run, you know, it's a dress rehearsal kind of thing and that's it. But the main event never takes place. My. Don't live like that. Give yourself to interacting with the Lord. And somebody said, well, I want to. Can you show me how? Yeah, it's very, very simple. Once you've been born of the Spirit, the great gulf that existed between you and God is removed. Now you've been made one with Him. You brought into His presence, and now there's a great gulf between you and every hindrance. There's a great gulf between you and all powers of darkness and sin. And that's what Paul was expressing in the book of Galatians. He was, Ilabo kushakaranameki shakoromakayatekeataya. Leprasayate, pikorositara. Be careful not to interrupt the Lord. Seberastikere machikeliapataya. Halabasataya. Hallelujah. Be careful not to interrupt the Holy Ghost and the flow of the Spirit of God. Be careful to be reverential. Hallelujah. To the things that the Spirit of the living God is doing here in this place, wants to do here in your life. Be careful to let your heart be united with Him. Be careful to let all those things that have occupied your mind and have kept you back from all that God has given to us in abundant life, not to be able to infect you and afflict you here in this place. Somebody said, how hard is it? I tell you, it's so easy. All you got to do is begin to give thanks. Somebody said, you don't understand. I'm concerned about my situation. I'm concerned about my life. I don't know why all these things are going wrong. I tell folks over and again, you focus on the wrong thing. You focused on what you don't have rather than what you do have. You focused on what you think that God hasn't done rather than what God has done. You need to let all that be changed now. You need to begin to think, you need to begin to focus on the things that the Spirit of the Lord has already accomplished for your life. You need to focus on the good things that has been brought because of this wonderful change. You need to focus on the fact that God still loves you, that He sent His only begotten Son, that Jesus died at Calvary's cross for you. You need to focus upon this love and this life and this mercy and this grace that never runs out, never runs dry. It's a well that never runs dry. It's a wellspring that never runs dry. Hallelujah. It's one that Baramasete Romondaya. It's one that you can count on. Barasebrebeki Labosabrati. Malambra dare di Prasaya. Is it Romongai? It's simple for those who know how to give thanks. Rosataranaradaya. Mananana flows out to the by the for those who are giving themselves over to the things of the Spirit, exercising themselves in the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Yeah. Not too long ago, Daniel started having me do the P90X with him, and some of those moves I wasn't very limber with, you know. And then they exercise you to death trying to shock your body into something else. But at any rate, hey, but you just stay with it. You start practicing. You hopping around. You jumping around. You doing things you haven't done, you know, since you were, you know, last in shape, really and really good in shape. Really good shape. Because you're giving yourself to something. You're giving yourself to a practice. I'm not going to give myself to a practice of having a religious expression. I'm not going to do that. I don't want you to do that. I don't care what that religious expression is. Whether that religious expression is defined as a concept of prayer, or whether that religious expression is defined as tongues or whatever, I'm not going to give myself to that. I'm going to give myself to interacting with the Holy Ghost, to receiving something real from Him, something tangible, something that fills me, something that is real, more real in its effect than anything else I experience in life. Some people don't even have as real of a move of God in their life as they get from their coffee that they drink. There's more of an effect from the caffeine than from the moving of the Holy Ghost in their life. I'm telling you, this is the truth. It's a sad truth. I'm not being facetious. I'm not being sarcastic. I'm just saying this is the reality. And it isn't God's will for anyone. It's God's will to fill you up to the full so that you're overwhelmed with a divine presence. And so many people don't even have ability even to relate to what I'm saying. There's really no way to even connect with what that means. But I'm telling you right now, you take every pleasure that you've ever known in this world, every thrill and every excitement, you put it all together in one place, and I mean the best time, the good time, whatever it was, and then you multiply that by a value that is eternal called the life of God, and that's what it's like to interact with the Holy Ghost. I heard a preacher recently say, he said, these people that come into church and they stand with their hands in their pocket when we're worshiping, they have, and I don't care what, his words were great. I don't care what they say about knowing God. They do not know Him, because you can't stand in the presence of one you know who's like Jesus Christ with your hands in your pocket. It doesn't matter what you say. These things are true. And I believe the world around us knows whether or not we've got something going on in our life that's real to us. They know that whether we got something going on in our life that has an impact when all of the circumstances of the situation of life and disappointments are overwhelming you. The only way the circumstance and disappointment can overwhelm you is because it has a great impact and has a great value and has a great meaning to you. But what God would do is He'd cause you to understand who He is and the light that He has for you, so that that doesn't have any meaning anymore. It has very little meaning. I mean, it's valuable to me to make sure that the bills are paid. It's valuable to me to make sure that there's gas in the car. It's valuable to me to make sure that people aren't offended unnecessarily. I just know that people are going to be offended, and I'm going to stop on that one for just a minute, because there's going to be a lot of people who sit and there's been a lot of people who sit and listen to me preach and other ministers like me, and they've never had one moment in their heart where they were truly committed to change, truly committed to obeying what was being said. All they did was filter everything according to their own thoughts, their own ways, their own wants, and their own wishes. So people are going to be offended. We don't want people to do that, but it doesn't have such a meaning and such a value that it becomes a crisis in my life. It shouldn't be a crisis in your life. If your house burned down, there shouldn't be a crisis in your life that would cause you to be impacted in such a way you can't interact with God the Holy Ghost anymore. And that's my point. It may be a crisis to some degree, but it wouldn't stop your thanksgiving. It wouldn't stop your praise. It wouldn't stop the reality of the interaction of divine power of God. If all of the things that you owned, all your stocks, all your shares, all your cattle, and maybe you had 10,000 cattle, and I mean, I'm talking like Job, you know, right now, and more camels and sheep than could be numbered, and they were all run off and destroyed. Still, it can't touch you. Can't touch you. Now your children are killed, and it can't touch you. Now your wife can't touch you. You know, it doesn't take long to look at the life of Job, but just in the first few chapters of the book, and understand why God called him a perfect man, upright in all his ways. And it was all really about his attachment to the Lord. Abraham's righteousness was all about his attachment to God. It's all about his willingness to trust God, where that nothing was bigger than his relationship. Nothing was bigger than his trust. I mean, the enemies that he was going to face, going out from the place of protection in the land of Ur, where he was from, among his family and among the soldiers and the governmental power and the means by which they found their security, it had very little value. His heart was so attached to God. He didn't have to calculate it. He didn't have to get the bank records out. He didn't have to reconcile it. He didn't have to go through some kind of logic to figure out whether it was the right choice. Love does something to you. Love will make you a dummy. Love will cause you to check out all, remove away and check out of all that is rational and sensible to men. These things couldn't affect him, the possibilities that he would face, because there's something called trust, there's something called value, something called treasure, something called purpose, identity, that which is most important to you. Let me tell you what's the most important thing to you. Would you like to hear? Many of you may not know it. It may be a shock to you. But it's your own personal life. It's your breath. It's more important to you than anything else. It may be hard for the younger people to understand, but as you get older, you can understand it more. Your life, your personal life. So precious to you. You make sure everything is perfectly taken care of to give you the greatest security, the greatest comfort, the greatest protections, your contingency plan, A, B, C, D, E, and F. Not just a single contingency. But what happens when all of those things suddenly are replaced by something far more important? And I tell you, there's only one way that this can happen. You have to have an encounter with the living God. Hallelujah. Now, let's just say that I know that people have had encounters with God, but they got distracted. They were turned away with religion. They were turned away with other ideologies, other practices, other beliefs. Some they taught themselves. Some others taught them. And then they begin to place things before this relationship. They had a real encounter with God. There was a first love. It was like, you know, you go down the street with your head out the window screaming to everybody, Jesus loves you. He wants to manifest himself to you. I mean, there's no shutting you up. There was no holding you back. I mean, you were like the man who was, you know, crippled and went leaping and walking and leaping and praising God. You couldn't stop. The first love was burning on the inside of you. All you wanted to do was follow him, and it didn't matter. If somebody would have said, look, here's what God's plan for you to do. Here's a parachute. Get in that airplane. We're going to fly you over the worst part of the jungle of the Congo, and you're going to jump out. You were all in. You're giving me the thing. Strap me in right now. Let's go. Because love had captivated your heart. Nothing else had value. Nothing else had meaning. Your life didn't even have real value or meaning to you. You were just caught away into heaven. Oh, what happens when you have that and can keep it? What happens when the people of God can experience this, or the lost can experience this and not lose it, not become dissatisfied and disgruntled and unhappy and unrealized expectation and disappointment surmounting so high because you didn't get what you wanted out of life? I encourage you to turn your thoughts and your directions back into the right place. I encourage you to start thinking about what God has done for you. I encourage you to think about the moving of the Spirit that is available to you. And then you'll begin to get hungry for the things that God wants to do in the future rather than living in the disappointment of your past and the failure of your past. You know what I do with failure? As soon as it happens, I resolve myself to success. Listen to me. And I pray you come follow me. If you do fail, at that very moment, resolve yourself to success. I will not be defeated on anything. If I plant a plant and it dies, I'm going to plant 10 more. And I'm going to do it right this time. And if those 10 die, I'm going to plant 100 more. But I'm going to do it right this time. Resolve myself to success. You don't just give up. You don't just give up. Even on small, meaningless things like that, like growing a plant. How much more? These things that have been made available to us in Christ Jesus, that God has sworn with an oath that he promised with his own blood at Calvary's cross. Abraham didn't really have God swear with an oath at first. You might even say he whispered and said, Abraham, come out from among. You want to know me? Just a whisper. You want to know me? I'll show myself and I'll reveal myself to you. Come walk with me in a place that is unfamiliar to you. Well, to start off with, most people are right there at that moment. They are eliminated. And it could be proven in your life if you'll allow things to be examined by the Holy Ghost. Folks don't like to walk in unfamiliar territory. They don't like to step out into the regions of faith. I tell you, faith is not lazy. It is the greatest force known to man. It will jar every fear. It will challenge every risk-taking thing in your life. That's why very few people move into that region. The only way you can move into that region is you've got to be a new creation. And this morning I started talking to you about Galatians chapter 6, verse 15. Tonight I want to begin to give you the corollary verses of Scripture that are in Galatians 5, 6, where he says exactly the same thing. And I'm going to give you those corollary verses in Corinthians chapter 7 and other places where the Lord is dealing with this issue of the new creation. And what is the fruit of it? And what is the result of it? It all comes down to this. It comes down to an empowerment to so trust God that it's with total abandonment that you live now, because your life isn't really meaningful to you anymore. Your stuff doesn't even matter. One of my wife's first great testings, and And I was blown away by it. Personally, I was blown away by it. We were, you know, we just bought a house, and it was many years ago. And could you fix that? Can you hear all that? And because if I move the microphone up and down, it's going to mess with the recording. But at any rate, praise God. Father, I thank you for wisdom in everybody's life. I know people get captivated by the anointing and forget about everything else. I realize that. But some of you are going to have to stay plugged in. Can everybody still hear? Because it keeps getting swung. There's no reason for me to talk and people can't hear. Right? I want everybody to be able to hear. If at any moment in time you can't hear, just wave at me. I know exactly what's going on. I won't think it's a moving of the Spirit of the living God. I know that we need something, and those guys will be watching back there as well. But at any rate, some people gave us a horse. And we love horses. We didn't have any horses at the time. They gave us this horse. Horse was named Sunday. We went away, I think it was to church. I'm not exactly sure, or vacation or something. I don't remember exactly what it was. It was church. And there was a person at the house, and the horse just got out. It was just, you know, in the yard. Leave the horse alone. Well, the person who doesn't know anything about the horse goes to chasing the horse. And one thing turns into another, and now they chase the horse out of the yard. Now they're chasing the horse down the dirt road. Leave the horse alone. The horse will come back and knows where its food is. No, they don't understand this. They chase the horse down the dirt road to the paved road. Then they don't stop there. They continue to chase the horse up the paved road to the highway. Bang! It's hit with a car. Our fault. No insurance kind of thing. We're sued. You're losing it all. So Ann goes, I don't care. It's fine with me. I have my salvation. We have our names written in the book of life. That's all that matters. Let them have it all. Whatever else they need. Come on, man. I'm like, thank you, Father, for the wife that you gave me. Hallelujah. Who loves you more than anything in this life. Loves you more than house and land. Oh, loves you more than anything. Food. Relationships. Friends. Whether people like us or not. Man, I tell you right now, if you want to be well-liked, don't go into the ministry. It is the most challenging public figures on the face of the earth. It's just unfortunate that it's that way, because there should be great honor. But most of the flack and the problem actually comes from my own house. The persecution actually comes from my own house. The household of faith, that is, or what's supposed to be the household of faith. Household of trust. Huh? Household of total abandonment unto God, so that I'll do anything that he asked me, and he's asked me to do absolutely everything that is impossible, that no possible power in the human realm would be able to meet up to the expectations of the living God. That whether we do not do anything after the flesh, for it has no power, no human ability, can ever in any way achieve those things which God demands. That's why no flesh can glory in his presence. Ah, but he empowered us, infused us with the Holy Ghost. And it's wonderful to come to know him and count on him. And I'm going to tell you, the times we really get to have the greatest statements of, Lord, I trust you and I rely upon you, is in the disaster, it's in the crisis. Where it's just like, Father, and I don't even care. It's yours. With total abandonment, I follow you, I serve you. Hallelujah. And then, watch out. Because you get yourself a relationship with the Lord and something starts happening. And he already hears you when you're just walking around giving him thanks and giving him praise. But now something's on the order of threatening you, contrary to the things that God has commanded. And you hit your face and you begin to cry out, Father, on my behalf, arise. Ooh, now. You get to enjoy a whole nother dimension of God who executes judgment and righteousness on your behalf, who stands for you in such a way that no weapon formed against you is able to prosper, who makes a way for you in the midst of a wilderness and desert place and sets before you a table to feast and enjoy yourself in the presence of your enemies. Ah, hallelujah. These are the things that God's people are going to have to come to know if you're ever going to be able to step out and be used by Him. And I'm telling you, when the power of the Holy Ghost comes upon you, all fear will lose its hold. The power of the Holy Ghost comes upon you, fear and intimidation will lose its hold. Logic and rational reasonings of men will lose its hold. I can show you on the day of Pentecost, they sat there in the upper room. They were afraid. They thought the same thing that happened to Jesus was going to happen to them. The doors were locked. They were having the meeting inside the house. But as soon as the power of God came upon them, as soon as they were infused, filled up, overwhelmed with heaven, divine power. Heaven is not of this world. It is another realm. Heaven. Suddenly they staggered out into the street as drunken men. They were so filled with divine pleasure. They were so filled with the ecstasy of divine glory. They were so raptured with now the glory of heaven, the glory of the very presence and person of the living God stepped into the life, speaking out of the voice. Hallelujah. And it began. It began. They were overshadowed with the glory of God. Just like Jesus was overshadowed with the glory of God on the Mount of Transfiguration. Just like Mary was overshadowed by the glory of the Holy Ghost and the holy thing that was conceived on the inside of her. My goodness, just like Peter's shadow overshadowed them. When Peter overshadowed them. Hallelujah. It's true. Not just shadow, but overshadowed them. Because the living God was now on the inside of a man called Peter. And when Peter overshadowed, God overshadowed. My goodness gracious people, that isn't just a one time, give me two shakes in a row. That isn't just an event in a ministry or a meeting. That is an encounter with God that you now allow to develop and allow to grow in the hard times, in the challenging times, in the threatening times, in the times that are impossible for you to make it. And yet you put your trust in God. So that 1,000 would stand by you, 1,000 would fall by your side, and 10,000 by your right hand, but it wouldn't come nigh you. People, that's disaster. Now listen, I'm gonna tell you right now, you listen to me, that it caused your heart to melt. If you got a little bit of cardiovascular disease, you'd fall over dead for fear. Huh? I know you've been safe in your little house here, and you got your 911, the police on every corner, and the fireman right down the street, you know, and everything's all nice and secure. But I'll take you out in the woods, and I'll tell you right now, it's first roar of that bear, we're going to find out what's going to happen in your life. Huh? Because I've watched people, and they're brave. They're brave, fear nothing. Huh? And we bear hunting. You see, you're going right up that hill right there. That's a good spot for them. They love that place right up there, straight up and down, right up there on the top. Huh? They get up there and they hear this. Guns abandoned. They didn't know they could run so fast downhill. And they got a story to tell about how it was about to take their head off. The bear was going the other direction. It was going actually running away from you. And you were running away from it. But now, go now. Get yourself in a play. Get yourself in a warfare. Get yourself in the heat of a battle, where there's 1,000 falling by your side, and 10,000 by your right hand. Stonewall Jackson had a statement that he said, because of his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, he felt as safe in bed as he did on the battlefield. That's an interesting relationship with God. It's an interesting relationship with God to feel as safe at home in bed. You do on the battlefield, because Father has determined everything will happen in your life. And a little bit of a different doctrine than I understand the Word of God to reveal, but nonetheless, it surely was a statement of complete abandonment to trust in God. So really, I'm looking at the bigger picture rather than the semantics, rather than the ideology and how they put it all together. I'm looking for some people trust God. I'm looking for some people take their doctrinal ideas and all the things that they say that they know about God and let it become living reality. You're going to grow in that. See, God, through what Jesus did at Calvary, sanctified you. In other words, He consecrated you and made you holy. He gave to you, by the blood of the sprinkling of Jesus, He sanctified us. He made us holy and set us apart to be holy, so that we could grow and mature in His presence, so that we could live and thrive in every good thing. It's hard to get an apple tree to go grow out there in the Mojave Desert. It's hard to get them. You can't get it to grow. You can't get it to grow. But if you dig and you put that tree right down in a nice fertile soil where there's plenty of water and rain, anywhere along the coast of Oregon, my goodness, that in Washington, them apples gonna get big. Oh yeah, the Lord took you out of a dry and a desert place where it was impossible for you ever to develop and ever thrive in the things of God, enjoying relationship with Him, and He set you right down into the paradise of God, into the paradise of His presence. He put you right into the inner circle of those who know Him. The inner circle of those who know Him. Oh my God. Hallelujah. I believe that we live in the days of the greatest opposition that anybody else in the history of mankind since Adam has faced. Because we've been given such an ability and such a power by the wonderful working of the Holy Ghost to fully represent God. And we've been called to live in the greatest of all times, to stand for God and to thrive in the greatest of all times. But there are the challenges that go along with it, that are the challenges above any challenges of all times. And somebody is going to have to learn how to have a relationship, to be separated, to be made holy by God, to receive that as a gift. That's who I am. That's my identity. I'm fully accepted in the Beloved. I didn't earn it. I'm just kept by the power of God, and I trust Him to keep me. And here, set apart unto Him. Now I'm going to develop, and I'm going to grow, and I'm going to mature, and I'm going to learn to walk this walk, and I'm going to give myself to it. And it doesn't matter what it takes. I'm going to participate. Yeah. People just want to fail. Just want to sit there and fail. I failed. Get up, you whining crybaby. Get up. Somebody said, don't call me that. I feel worse now. Well, listen. You took it on the schoolyard. You can take it here in church. The reality of it is that's what Paul said. He said, be courageous like men. Quit whining. Be strong. That's what he said. That's what he was saying. And the Greek phrase would be just really quit. I'm going to stop. Forgive me. Are you ready? Quit being a sissy. Okay. Quit being, be strong like men. Come on, be courageous. Yeah, you got a lot of opposition coming at you, but big deal. It can't even be compared or measured to the glory. The darkness and the opposition can't be measured or quantitated and valued in comparison to the wonderful light of His presence, to the divine power of His grace that has been given to you and me. Satan is a very small little thing in contrast to the Holy Ghost. But we turn it around, turn it all upside down. Problems and circumstances, situations that only have a temporal meaning and temporal value and temporal effect. Problems and issues that only are restricted to a season of time. I sit and listen to Oral Roberts in his living room before he died, watching a man of God who went through things that nobody else went through, took more grief than most preachers have ever taken in his life, raised more money for the kingdom of God than anybody ever had up until this day, raised $2 billion for the kingdom of God. Stood faithful to the Lord, stood faithful to the sacred things of God, the anointing of God. I mean, I saw it in his life because it was a friend of mine there wanted him to pray over his son, and even his wife Evelyn was saying, look, you need to pray over him. And he's like, listen, I'm not doing anything God the Holy Ghost doesn't tell me to do. What are you talking about? I'm blessed him, but you're trying to get me to do something. I can't go beyond God. Come on now. I'm like an aged man in the Holy Ghost saying that. What a blessing. He said there, he's talking to me. He says, Mark, everything has a season. It's just a season. It's gonna start and it's gonna end. Everything is a season. And he started, your life is a season. Events have a season. All you gotta understand is the proper response in the seasons. And if you respond properly, there is going to be a great advancement and a great promotion, and you can look at it just in the season and expand of your life. Should you just walk faithfully with God, the promotion of heaven, my goodness gracious. How about the events of suffering? How about the challenges when things aren't going your way, when things aren't happening the way you want them to take place? Hallelujah. I stand around and praise God for his goodness. Hallelujah. I don't stand around and think about whatever it is that is not working out according to my plans and prediction. I just praise him for his goodness. I praise him for his divine authority. I thank him for his my name for having my name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I thank him that he's my God and that I'm his person. I'm his people. I thank him because he loves me so much that he gave everything he has to bring me into himself. God, it cost God a lot to have relationship with me. Cost God a lot to have relationship with you. It's not cheap. Cost him a lot. He esteemed my life, your life, more valuable than his own life. My goodness gracious, come on now. Let's turn this thing around. Wow, what's my response going to be? My Lord, I'll go anywhere you want me to go. I'll do whatever you want me to do. I said to my wife the other day, I said, honey, we're going to go do this. And it was basically eliminating any hopes of sleep and rest. And she just looked at me. She said, okay. Whatever the Lord wants. Are we going to, wow, we're just going to live big for God. Because you could sit back and you could calculate, well, you know, it's going to cost us this and going to cost us that, and we're not going to, Watch out. You be the servant of men, servant of yourself. Be the servant of mammon. Mammon has many expressions, and it's not just money. It's your opinion and man's opinion. Cursed is every man who trusts in the arm of flesh. But you know what? When you fall in love, you just do crazy things. You do crazy things. We're going on a road trip. We're going for it, man. We're going to go and we're going to do a bunch of all-nighters for 3 weeks. Because you just head over heels in love. We're just in love. We're in love with Christ Jesus. We're in love with the kingdom of God. We're in love with the Holy Ghost. We're in love with his master plan of the master. What he's blessed us with. I possess nothing. I own nothing. I have nothing. Anything I have, it's something that God gave me to utilize in his kingdom. And if I do it right, he'll bless it and multiply it so that it will be more and will always function and come to me in the realms of the miraculous through a realm that I cannot predict. It will be completely and totally unknown. It will be out of my power to make it happen. And that's how I choose to live. That's how Abraham chose to live. It's how Job chose to live. It's how Jesus lived. It's how Paul lived. It's how the men and the women of faith will live this day. Hallelujah. Costa Caranea told you. So I want you to look at this verse of scripture. And hallelujah. In Galatians chapter 5 and verse 6. Ha ha ha. Vodumasitia. Ha ha ha. Haratikina galandadoya. Herimonsikina. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Thank you for the anointing. Then Paul says, circumcision doesn't give you any advantage. Do you see that? Yeah. And uncircumcision doesn't give you any disadvantage. Do you see that? All that matters is a person who's made a new creation. All that matters is, you're going to say it this way, though, this time. All that matters is faith that operates by love. Oh, so I'm just going to love Geneva, and I'm going to love David, and I'm going to love Bill, and I'm going to love you. We're going to have faith. That's not what he's talking about. That's not what he's talking about. We all just going to sit around and hold hands and sing, and everything will be fine. That's what our government believes. Our government believes we can all just hold hands with each other and sing, and everything's going to be just fine. Meanwhile, the rest of the world is planning a complete takeover, the United States of America. We just hold hands and sing, and everything's going to be just fine. We all will love one another. That's not what it's talking about. It's talking about our love with the Lord. It's talking about our first love. It's talking about a love interaction that's going on between us and the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Not something that's spotty. Huh? Spotty. Many people have a spotty relationship with the Lord. You know, spotty cell phone service. Can you hear me now? You know, what I tell you right now, it was a good campaign. It worked out well for Verizon. They ultimately ended up having the best coverage in the United States of America because they continually did a coverage of, can you hear me now? Can you? Some people of God need to walk around going, can you hear me now, Holy Ghost? Can you hear me now? They need to be testing things out, huh? Now, everybody else is bombed by, because I tell you, there's some cell phone services that you got to get in one little spot, in one little region, and that's the only place it works. It's it. It's it. Sunday morning, it's the only place that even begins to get a little bit of connection. I think I can hear you. It's a little staticky. But I think I got what? No, you're cutting up on me again. You're breaking up. You're breaking up on me. I can't really call back. Or I'll call you back, get a better line. The Lord wants to get rid of your spotty relationship. He wants these things to become a living reality in your life. And guess what? He's already made it that. Now you got to make it that. That's the problem. That's the problem. He's sitting around waiting for God to make something, to do something, and make the reality of something, which he's already made. He's already done. And they sit around and act like he's got to do something. There's nothing but doubt and unbelief, and God's not going to reward that. Not to respond to it. Huh? We're not waiting on God. God's waiting on us. He's waiting on us. You get over here and begin to get positive about things, not negative, about everything. To be in faith, to be confident, a confidence of faith that comes because you're romantically in love. You're overwhelmed with this love. You're captivated with love that has great honor and respect, that has great familiarity and attachment, this parental love. It's even you could say it's even on the, well, it goes beyond this maternal love, but it's all of these things. You just begin to lump everything together about real good love, real love, real, I'm romantically in love with my wife. Do you understand that? And this thing's been going on for 29 years, and it keeps getting better. This is not a quote-unquote crush. This is not fictitious love. This is real romantic love that's beautiful. It's not cheap. It's beautiful. Every day, she becomes more beautiful. To me, she's the most beautiful woman on the planet. Why would I look at some other woman when I've got the most beautiful person on the planet right here with me? I mean, goodness gracious, I'd be out of my mind to do such a thing. Sometimes when we say romantic love, people don't get it. It's a romantic love. And that's what Paul said. I'd do anything to win Christ. He said, I count everything within the framework of that which was made available to me, that which I had, that which I could boast in, that which I could say I've accomplished, I can't classify it as all crap or dung. And there's several other words. And I like to get the impact of it. Poop. Dung. Is it maybe a little bit too, you know, maybe it's just a little bit too reduced. I'm not scared of that for you. And I must be, you know, transparent. There have been many things about my life that I held on to in terms of accomplishments, what I think I could do, who I think I am, what I think I'm worth, what I think I deserve, that held me back from my first love. They held me back from really enjoying all that he wanted to give me, to where it's all him doing it, not me. I want to bring stuff around along with me instead of classifying it as something that's, woo, get rid of that, flush it quickly, bury it, whatever, get it away from us. No one wants that around. Oh, let me show you guys my stuff. Pretty gross, eh? I'm not wanting to be impactive. Suddenly you begin to measure the value of all that you've done on that level. And it's just like, wait a minute, man, this is going to be too much for me. Can you please change subjects? No, this is the most important subject because it's our holding on to ourselves. It's keeping us back from the best. If you want to gain life, you're going to have to lose it. Huh? You want the good stuff, you're going to have to begin to reckon that there's a lot of deception been going down in your territory, going down in your house, going down in your life, going down in your mind. You valued yourself and you valued your stuff even above Christ Jesus, but you don't understand it. I didn't understand it. Huh? Our life would play tricks on us. Our thoughts would play tricks on us. But it really begins to come to a test. Things begin to come to a test in our lives when we begin to be challenged. There is an old saying that God never takes you into deep waters to drown you, but to cleanse you. I don't believe it that way. I believe that God never takes you into deep waters to drown you, but to perfect you. Hallelujah. The person who came up with that saying, it's an old saying, who is unknown. But the reality of it is most people won't go there. They won't go there. They just scream and whine and choose to do it their own way. How about with total abandonment, you begin to serve God? Let me just tell you, it's impossible for you to do this until you've been born of the Spirit. When you're born of the Spirit, now you're moved by the Spirit. You're not moved by your own life anymore. Before, I lived my life under my own inspirations, what I thought. This is what I believe. This is what I think. This is what's important to me. But then I was born of the Spirit. And just like the wind, where I don't know where it's coming from, I don't know where it's going, all of a sudden, that's what began to happen in my life. I began to be moved by the unseen force and power of the living God to do things that went beyond the human framework and functioning and thinking that belonged to the realms of the human mind. Think about this verse of Scripture in Galatians chapter 5 and verse 6. God is saying this. He said, look, I don't care nothing about your religion. I don't care nothing about whether you circumcise, and literally, it literally says your circumcision has no advantage and your foreskin has no disadvantage. So I'm going to really break it down, okay? Because that's really what it says. We just kind of sanctified a little bit. You know, uncircumcision sounds better. It doesn't say uncircumcision. It says foreskin. Doesn't matter. None of your religion, none of your activities, none of your background, none of your culture, none of who you are, what you're about, what people you came from, what your genealogies, how great your great-great-grandfather was, what you did last year, who cares? Your great accomplishments in life doesn't matter. Your failures in life doesn't matter. All that matters is God wants to see some people who begin to move in faith that operates out of a relationship of love with the Father. That's all that matters with Papa. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Those that come to God must believe that He exists. That He exists. And that He's here to do everything He said He would do. He's here to resource you, back you up. Now. Hallelujah. Praise God. I said to an older man of God one time, I said, yeah, well, you know, the Lord wants us to be prompt, doesn't want us to be late. He says to me, God's late all the time. What are you talking about? He does it when He's good and ready. He's going to test you. So don't be so uppity about being prompt. Pretty powerful, huh? God's a little bit late for you. Didn't come in at the Calvary, right in like the Calvary at the last moment. And now what are you doing? Guess what? They may persecute you a little bit. Bill Mann may call you up and get all upset and threaten to foreclose, but it ain't going to happen. Father's going to come through. Over and over again, we watch God come through. Amen. Oh, well, your word and your reputation is being marred. I don't have one. Mine's dung. Mine's poop. Huh? I don't have one. I live for Him. I'm stepping out on faith. I'm going to do things. I'm going to take risks. I'm going to do what God told me to do. Huh? I'm not going to calculate it. You can't calculate what God wants to do. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Hallelujah. I'm going to step out in faith. Hallelujah. I'm going to walk on the water. Amen. Come on now. The Lord's saying, circumcision, uncircumcision. Now, just jump right back to Galatians chapter 6, verse 14 again. I was ministering on this morning. Once again, he says the exact same thing. I want you to look at that. Your religion, your practices, where you come from, your culture, your successes, your failures, it doesn't matter. It means nothing. But a new creation. So we understand by looking at Galatians 5:6 and just looking at Galatians 6:14, we can see very clearly a connection between the reality of being made a new creation, now to be walk in the Spirit, to be a man of the Spirit, to be a person who hears the voice of God and is moved by God. And the greatest force of that is this love, this passionate love. I mean, I've watched so many people step into salvation and do miracles that folks who sit around in the church have never even begun to fringe upon. Because they were immediately baptized in love. They weren't just, you know, warming up to the idea and can't even tell you when they got saved. They could tell you the very date and hour. My wife celebrates her birthday, her Kingdom of God birthday every year, as much as she celebrates, anything else. And there's something different about that for people. Some people are born into religion. They don't ever know how to step out of religion. They're stuck. It's a terrible, tragic thing. But when that new birth experience comes and that encounter with God comes, you're overwhelmed by a love that is created by the one who produced and created all things. How many of you understand that everything that was created, everything that was produced, everything that was made in this world, in this earth, it was created by Jesus Christ? It's the opening statements that we read in John chapter 1, verse 3. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. He is the creator of the new creation. He's the one who created the new nature. He's the one who brought into our life the capacity and the ability to know God. What value is that to you? Watch out. Watch out. Because if we look at your time log, your work may be more valuable to you. If we look at your time log and your check log, your own expenditures may be more important to you. And you're wondering why you can't move forward, why the fire of God's not burning there. Somebody needs to teach you some abandonment. I'm here to do that. I'm here to teach you to get into the place where the glory is. I'm here to help remove you out of the realm that's held you back, to keep you from total abandonment. I know what the queasy feeling is. I know it. I've experienced it. I remember when the men of God stood around me and told me that the Lord has sanctified me, separated me to minister the gospel, to be a preacher, to be a minister of the gospel. And I'm like, nope, no, N-O, not going to do it. No, sir, I've already put my time in. I'll be a supporter, but I'm not going to be a minister. And then the Spirit of the Lord didn't let me sleep. And I was all sick to my stomach. Why? Total abandonment. Total abandonment. And I know I personally put some restraints on God, just being just very transparent with you, because, you know, I'm talking to you about things that I know, some many things that I experienced. And, you know, being raised in the ministry, we went through some challenging times, some struggles, that we had great miracles and signs and wonders in our lives. God did great things, but we had some challenging times. I don't believe that they were challenging times that were ordained by God. I believe that they were challenging times that we could have gotten through faster and it could have been different. But nonetheless, it was challenging. And at that time, I equated that in many respects to going into the ministry and serving the Lord, because I've seen the same thing happen in so many other ministers' lives and so many other families' lives. And I just said, Lord, you know, look, you know, okay, I'll be a minister, I'll serve you. Well, I'm going to be bivocational because I just can't trust you for the finances. Now, I didn't say it that way. You know why? Because we never say it that way. We just think it. And we think it almost on a level where we don't even admit it to ourselves that it's our thought. Huh? Until you start looking back on it, when you begin to get desperate, when you're in that place of fasting and praying, crying out to God and saying, Father, what does hinder? What holds me back? Because I know it's not you. And he begins to show us, well, it's because you're trusting too much in yourself, son. You don't have to let that go. I got something better for you. Hallelujah. I remember when I stepped out and just said, okay, Lord, no more bivocational thing. I'm going to step out here. I was so, once again, I was just so captivated by his love with his total abandonment. My wife was so captivated by his love with total abandonment. We just said, come on, we can go. We're just going to go do this. Come on, how can we put our lives more on the line? How can we risk more? How can we risk more, Father? Right now, I hear the nations of the earth calling. You must understand, you got to understand my passion. You got to understand my tension. You got to understand my burden. You got to understand my heart. You understand me. You got to understand where my heart's at. I hear the nations calling. I've never had time to be patient. Patience. I don't have time to learn how to be patient, kind of thing. But patience is going to have her perfect work. My son, evaluating me when he was about 10 or 11 years old, said, Mom, Dad only has one weakness that I can see. He's not patient. He needs to be more patient. He was right. I'm going to get it all done because we got so much more to do. Come on now, let's get it done. Let's do it now. Hurry. We're not done yet. Should have been done an hour ago. I know it's a job that's supposed to take 3 days and I want to get it done in 3 hours, but big deal. Let's do it now. Come on now. It's done. Let's go. I hear the nations calling. I hear Mongolia calling me. People say, I'm going to go to jail for it. If I go to Mongolia and do what we're going to do in Mongolia. No, we're going to go to Mongolia. They just started putting people back into prison in Nepal. I knew there was a window of time in Nepal. They just arrested and put one of Sudeep's ministers in jail. They came and put all of the elders, the pastor and all the elders of the church in chains. Publicly in chains, chained them in the long chains because they baptized 29 people in the water. And on the books, it's still illegal. See, they never changed the laws. When we were standing ministering to the masses in 2006, they never changed the laws. All the pastors were up there trembling. They said, we don't know what's going to happen. We could all go to jail. The Lord showed me that a Maoist communist had come to kill me, come to shoot me. And the power of God, and I watched him come with their weapons. I saw it happen. And then I saw the power of God touch them. And, you know, and I said to the pastor, I said, please, let's go baptize them. Let's go baptize all of these people that are coming in the kingdom. How are we going to get all this done? They said, please, don't ask us to do this. We've already risked our lives. Standing here on this platform with you, he says, we've had so many government officials. We've had so many people. There's so many pictures and photos of us already. Please, let's not. We're supposed to already be in jail. If the Lord showed me there was a window of time, 2008. God allowed us to do that, which nobody would have ever believed could have ever happened. People don't even understand that. I believe there's people here in this sanctuary that don't understand it. It will be talked about in history. Then people will be able to say, wow, look at that. To go into a nation and take the icon of that nation that's been held in the grips of Hinduism for 3,000 years and take their icon that stands for their national religion that gives them their identity in Hinduism and plant the flag of the kingdom of God and of his Christ. To do those kinds of things. Father has given us the anointing, the capacity to do it if we learn how to move in an abandonment of love, in a romance, in an honor, in a trust, in a maternal, paternal, every kind of love you can think of, a brotherly, every kind of love there is, stacked together, poured into a heart. It just causes us to do things with total abandonment. Hallelujah. We're not done in Nepal. I mean, we know when we went in and we met with the Prime Minister and of the Interior and, you know, and all these various different government officials and one of the leading communist Maoist leaders, one of the leading parliamental leaders of the Maoist movement, sat down with me. Her husband was the highest ranking general and the Maoist army, and he had died, and she had been put in the highest position of leadership. She's a young radical revolutionary, and the Lord grabbed a hold of her heart She fell in love with me right there. She said, can I please come and learn from you and come to the Mission Training Center? When can I come? Can we give you 300 hectares of land wherever you want them? You have our protection. Whatever you need, ask me. Come on now. Huh? I hear the nations calling. I could do that in Kashmir. I could do that in the Sudan. I could do that in North Korea. So can you, with total abandonment and love. And somebody said, well, what if you die? Then I get to go to heaven. Just a little quicker, I get to see Jesus. I get to walk around in glory. I get to receive the martyr's crown, along with the other crown, so that I have more than one crown to throw at his feet. Huh. When the praises come down, they only go up to him. Hallelujah. When I'm Rusadaya, when he gives me honor, I'm going to take that honor and I'm going to put it before him. And I'm going to say, thank you, Lord Jesus. But I do that now. I do that now. I don't have to have anything other than the life he's given me. I don't have to have anything other than the Holy Ghost that he's given me. I do that now. And then over and again, we'll be faced with the storms of this life. We'll be faced with the wind and the rain beaten ferociously against our dwellings, against our future, against what we believe we should do and have, our security. But if our life has been captivated by his love, it'd be up on the rock and we'd be unmovable, we'd be unshakable. Hallelujah. We won't care, with total abandonment. We say, Father, I am yours. And you know, you need to learn how to have that kind of interaction. You need to learn. You can follow me. I will give you tips, but it's got to be valuable to you or meaningful to you. Otherwise, you're going to forget. Some of you may fall asleep before you ever even leave the place because it's just about that important. It's true. What it takes of people a long time for reality to become important to them because they have so many things they're going to do. So many ideas, so many purposes, so many things to achieve, so many things to accomplish. The Lord wants to turn all that away from you and show you what it is. It's nothing but wood, stubble, and hay to be burned up. It has no value, no lasting meaning. He wants to turn your heart to that which is lasting. He wants to cause your life to be firmly established upon the rock, Christ Jesus. He wants you to learn how to walk out this wonderful realm of divine faith, which only works by love. It's all that matters to God. If I could help you understand today that all that matters to the Father isn't your church attendance. It isn't how much money you gave in the offering. It is not how many hours you spent fasting and praying. It's not what your culture is. It's whether or not you're willing to walk in a faith that works by love. It's whether or not you're willing to walk in an abandonment of trusting God that was modeled for us by the father of faith, Abraham. Don't make it something different. Because I watch people make faith something different all the time. They make it, faith is because I believe in Jesus and I show up for church on Sunday morning. That isn't faith. Because Abraham didn't do that. He didn't even have anything like that. He showed us a total abandoned trust to God. I risk everything I have. Everything is yours. Okay. Now give me your son. Give me your son a promise. You finally got your promise. The Lord promised to bless him, to make his heirs innumerable. More than the stars that could be in the heavens, more than the sand upon the seashore. He said, how could this be, seeing as I go childless? All that only heir that I have is this Eleazar of Damascus, this Syrian. I'll give you a son. Father gave him the son. And then he says, take him now. After he loved on him for about 30 years old, till 30, listen to me. People saying all the time, oh, you're an adult. You can make your own decisions. Hey, you don't want to be an adult, and you never want to make your own decisions. Yeah. How you like that? You like apples? How you like them apples? Are you listening to me? Yeah. Huh? Hey, Isaac was about 30 years old. And Papa said, son, come on. Come on now. We're going to go worship. Father, behold, here is the fire. Here is the wood and the knife. Where is the offering? Abraham's faith. Father will provide for himself a sacrifice. Father will provide for himself a lamb. But then how about the moment in time where all of a sudden Isaac knows he's the lamb? What's he going to do? He's going to say, Dad, you've lost your mind. You've gone completely out of your mind. You flipped completely out. What are you talking about? I'm out of here. Huh? I was talking to the neighbors the other day. Their parents don't treat them like you've been treating me. You're controlling. People say, Pastor's controlling. People say, I'm controlling. And I'm like, I'm controlling. I didn't know that somebody said, he's controlling. And I said, I never even realized they ever even did anything for me. How could I be controlling if they never did anything for me that I know of? You with me? Isn't it a funny games that people play in the imaginations of their mind? Controlling. Never even done anything. I mean, if I was controlling you, you'd go do something for me, right? Jesus help us. Abraham took him, bound him tightly. And Isaac, being about 30 years of age, submitted himself to it. Go ahead, Dad. This is what you feel is right. Pretty radical, huh? What a family. What a family. Those kinds of sons only become those kinds of sons because of that kind of a model of a father that loves him. See, Isaac knew that his dad loved him more than his own life. He was the son whom he loved, that he dearly loved. Isaac was everything. And of course, he was smart enough not to tell Sarah about it, because it was going to be an argument, because what Sarah had gone through, maybe more than she could bear. Wisdom is a good thing. It was Abraham's responsibility anyways. That moment in time, with that kind of abandonment of trust, Father said, now I know. Now I know. I mean, I look at fathers many times and I say, Papa, do you know about me yet? Do you know that you got my heart? Do you know you got my passions? You know how you got my life? You know you got my will? He says to Abraham, now I know that you're my friend. Now I know that you fear me. Now I know that whatever I ask you, you would do it. So now, swearing by myself, I swear. And when you have Papa swearing, and what he's done is he's committed his love and his trust towards us, that he swore with an oath greater than any oath that could ever been could be made. He swore with a blood oath. And he swore with a blood oath more than just the cutting of the covenant, to just to have the blood of a vicarious offering, more than a blood brother oath of various different cultures, but he swore with the blood that cost his own life, for he died at Calvary's cross and poured out his blood, swearing to me, swearing to you with an oath that cannot be broken, of his love and commitment and the consecration of his life to our well-being. And now he looks at us and he says, will you trust me? Will you go for me? Will you go do what I told you to do? And then we deal with the fear. Huh? We deal with our inabilities. We deal with all of the scenarios that we can't figure out. And as a result, we sit upon our couch and we wait and say, oh God, use me. Oh God, use me. Oh God, fill me. Oh God, baptize me. He said, obey me. You're going to be willing to trust me. I'll give you everything. I'll give you everything. But it isn't just for you to sit around and do nothing with. It isn't for you to spend on your own interest. Tonight, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. As in the days when men tried to prove God. That's called the provocation of Hebrews 3 and 4. The word was preached to them, but didn't profit them. Can you see the profit in the word of God? Can you see the profit in your life because you now know how to function and flow in the gifts of the Spirit? You know how to flow and function in the manifestation of the Spirit? There's a profit for you. You say to sickness, go, and it has to leave. Hallelujah. There's a profit for you. You say, oh God, speak to me, and his voice becomes heard. You say, oh God, open up doors and use me, and doors begin to open. Hallelujah. Because you're willing to move, because you're willing to go. Not in the limited fashion of that which you believe you can accomplish and you can do. Because many times we're willing to go, but we're willing to go within the confines of those things that we can do. But Father wants you to go and do things that you can't do. He says, I want you to go with the purpose of raising the dead when you go. Would you go out to witness on his behalf? To do anything other than to go with the purpose of raising the dead is a false pretense. Because that's not how he said to go. I want you to go to cast out devils. I want you to go with power. I've infused you with divine ability and power to liberate men from the afflictions and the torments of demon power. Hallelujah. He just gives it to us. He gives it to us. I watched so many people. I've seen so many people. People that were just crazy hippies, drug addict hippies. Wild, crazy, from dysfunctional families, didn't even have mom and dad. Grew up in the back of the surf shop, completely stoned out of their mind all their life. Give their life to Jesus, immediately start doing signs, wonders, and miracles. Why the religious people sat around saying, oh God, come please. They were going and doing miracles and signs and wonders because there was no value or meaning within the framework of what they felt they could do. It's all a gift. God said to go do it. Let's go do it. While the educated and the knowledge and the wise and the prudent and the calculators sat back and did nothing, waiting for another day. God has to go find somebody who's going to be radical enough to recognize that they're not worthy or deserving of any of it. He just told them to go do it, and they're just willing enough to go do it. I got some good news for you. You could have been completely wiped out of your mind all the days of your life on religion. As one person said, religion. And it could have been kept you stoned out of your conscious realm of thinking all of your life. And tonight, things can change for you. You can have an encounter with God when you return to your first love, prapatai, or have an encounter where he becomes your first love. So you're so in love with him, you're going to go do anything he says to do. You do it. Hallelujah. And find the power and the grace and the miracle working ability of Jesus being expressed to your life. Hallelujah. How about when men and women have gone who've been raised in the church but never stepped into religion? Isn't that good? That's good. We got a model of it for you around here. And they go everywhere doing miracles. When Ruthiana was 14 years old and she asked me, Dad, I want to go to Romania. I'm like, my thoughts, you're not going to Romania. It's my baby. 14 years old, you're too young. I didn't say that. I thought about saying that. I just heard the Lord say, my hand's upon her. My anointing's on her. Don't take away from her the vision and purpose that I command. So I just gulped it all down and said, Father, I trust you. You can go. When my girls were in Africa, and I had a dream that both of them were being attacked by diseases, by sicknesses, coming up against the forces of hell that they had to deal with there. And then I had the dream on night before Father's Night, which would have been about, 4 years ago
yesterday. The Lord comes to me, and I see Ruth in a dream. She's sick. The Lord comes to me and says, it's not malaria. That's what he said. He spoke the word of faith. They called me up and they said, we just did a test for Ruthanna. She has malaria. I said, she does not have malaria. The Lord appeared to me in a dream last night. She doesn't have a malaria. Test her again. The test came back negative. Then we watched as she comes home and her eyes become extremely yellow. Bilirubin content was pretty elevated in her bloodstream. She had other symptoms of liver problems, symptoms of malaria. Just walked around praising God, thinking, she doesn't have any malaria. She's totally healed. You didn't get malaria. God says you didn't get malaria. Oh, but they say you didn't get malaria. So give no place to any of those suggestions that come out of the camps of darkness, come out of the strongholds of the enemy. Give no place. Praise God for his word. When we're walking in his word and we're overwhelmed by so many things, he in his grace and mercy comes to us sometimes and speaks to us in vision and says, here's what it is. But just because that doesn't happen, don't devalue your experience with God because you haven't gone through the load and the pressure that I've been under. Get under the load and pressure that ministers are under, and then, you may need a little extra help. And the Papa gives you a little extra help because I'm telling you right now, I'm more than likely, what if I got that telephone call, and though she was in the jungle of far outreaches of Africa, I would have gone on the airplane, and I would have flown there, and I would have gotten the first vehicle I could find that could go across country in a walkie-talkie. And I'd have been on that thing to go and rescue. It could have very easily happened to me at that particular time. Every day I learned to trust him. Hallelujah. He sanctified me and consecrated me, giving me the gift of holiness so that I could live in a realm of holiness, that I might learn from him and be taught by him so that I could fully mature into the fullness of the measure of the ministry of Jesus in every way, being conformed to the image of the Son. Those are two very powerful verses of scriptures, Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 24. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 29, I'm telling you, I seize those scriptures. I live for those things. And I know that ain't going to happen because I just passively sit around and just do whatever little I can get away with. I'm in love. I'm passionately in love. Ha! I'm not trying to earn anything. I'm in love. I'm not doing things out of something I deserve. I'm in love. I've got total abandonment. A life has been given to me. And I want you to know tonight, that same life is available to you. And all your stuff doesn't matter to Father. All that matters to him is faith that works by love. All your stuff and all your deeds and all your doings don't matter to him. All that matters to him is a new creation. Let me read one other verse of scripture to you in first, because I told you I was going to read it, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 18. Because he says that this is Paul saying the same thing again. Once again, he says, circumcision has no advantage. He says uncircumcision, and I'm going to keep it light there, okay? I've already given you the rough graphics. Verbiage. And uncircumcision has no disadvantage. Doesn't matter where you come from. Doesn't matter if you're male or female. Doesn't matter if you're from the worst culture, Scythian, or whether you're from the Hebrew culture, the most sanctified culture. Doesn't matter. Everybody's on an equal level. It's an equal field. It doesn't matter if your dad was priest all the way back to Aaron, and you can trace your genealogy from Moses. It doesn't matter if you're a descendant of Elijah or Enoch. It doesn't matter what your background is, or if you're a descendant from the worst evil person ever, Nimrod. God forbid. I don't think he has any descendants. But the keeping of the commandments of God. Look at these three things. Tonight I just want you to consider three things.
that the Apostle Paul puts together lays a huge foundation in 1 Corinthians for us to be able to understand it when we get to chapter 7. Lays a huge foundation for us to understand in Galatians before we get to Galatians 5, 6. Helping us to understand above all other things that this is walking in the Spirit. This is learning to live by the mind of Christ. Having the mind of the Spirit. Which I get out of Rastatara named Lapakurastaya. I don't get by thinking it out and reasoning it out. I will not. I won't struggle or wrestle the scriptures to my own destruction. Neither will I struggle or wrestle my own problems and my own issues and a plan and an avenue of escape and a resolve. No more. I've done it in the past, people. I've done it. I probably participated as much as anybody else in that ridiculous realm. And you're going to get really very little results in terms of divine results. But were you to stop and you say, I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm going to master that name Rosara and English to Peronaiati. I'm going to make old Dadana Masifeti do Padota Bada Dada and give thanks unto the Lord until I find myself with an understanding that has nothing to do with the reasoning but a direction of the Lord, the mind of the Spirit. Prophecy comes forth, the word of knowledge comes forth, a strong impression from the living God comes forth. And it's simple. It's very simple how God speaks. Very simple. And you've got to have a very soft and tender heart to hear it. You've got to be there. You've got to have been sowing into the things of listening to the Father. Because when the Lord told me to go to Nepal, it was a very still, small voice. It was this very strong impression came upon me. Strong impression. This stunned me. A strong impression. No, you are going. Because I was hollering at another preacher. Actually, you know who it was? Richard Moore. I was hollering at Richard Moore because Richard had been invitation to Nepal and he said he was thinking about going. And I'm saying, what is wrong with you, man? Don't you realize that the door just opened up just recently to even be able to have the opportunity on April the 28th to even be able to have the opportunity, 2006, to go in the place? What? And then as I'm laying him out, reading him the right act, about thinking about going when he's got an invitation, he's got an anointing and an invitation. Suddenly, the Lord's strong impression laid on me. No, you're going. And so I got real quiet. Now, he's on the other phone. I'm quiet. He thinks that now I'm just being quiet waiting for him. So now he starts backpedaling, saying, yeah, you know, you're right. I really need to rethink this thing. And he's just going on and on and on. And then he says, Mark, you all right? I said, yeah, man. He said, what's up? I said, I think I'm going. That was the beginning of faith that works by love, right there. Because I was out there already crying out to God, just a passion. Living in a passion. When you're living in this passion, when you're living in this praise, when you're living in this act of your heart's just there, you can hear. But if your heart's elsewhere, if it's all wrapped up in the cares of this life, you can't hear very well. It's all wrapped up in the other issues and all the other things and the special spot you're going to go for vacation. You know, I've watched as so many people have already left tonight. People that don't have this. They don't understand what I'm talking about. But they got to go. They got other things they got to do. It's challenging. It's a very challenging thing because the Lord still just has a few. Understand, many are called, but few are chosen. It's true. I just want you to be chosen. I just want you to win the prize. I just want you to be chosen. You're all called, but are you know, this is what the Lord says. He says, narrow is the entryway. Narrow is the way. He says, all your stuff doesn't matter to me. All your backgrounds don't matter to me. Successes, failures, but the keeping of the commandments of God. All your background, all your religion, all the stuff that you do, and all the things that you feel that are valuable doesn't matter to me. The faith that works by love. All the things that you said you've accomplished, and all the things that you said you've done on my behalf, and all the things that you say that you
can't do or haven't done, or be these successes or failures. Doesn't matter to me. A new creation. That's all that matters. And I could now back it out and say, first, it's the new creation, being born in the Spirit, so you can hear the Spirit and be led by the Spirit and walk in the Spirit. Second of all, is to keep the commandments of God. Or I could say, second of all, rather, it's now the love that works by faith. The faith that works by love. Rather. And then I could say the commandments. Keeping the commandments of God. Just being obedient to what He wants us to do. You know what the greatest commandment of God's? You know what God's greatest commandments are? You know what they are? Walk in love even as He loved us. Lay down your life for the brethren. How about lay down your life for Him? He is the brethren. Let me just say this. If you won't lay down your life for Him, you won't lay down your life for anybody else. I hear the Lord saying, softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. He's there on the portal. He's waiting and watching. Watching for you to come home. Come home. Quit wandering around out there. Come home. Jesus is calling. Come home. There's this place of just quiet rest. There's this place of living all your life in Him. Let God redefine your life and value of your life for you. Don't see if you got full-time employment, you got a job, don't see yourself there all the rest of your life. See yourself being launched out into ministry. See yourself doing great signs and wonders, going everywhere preaching the gospel. We're getting ready to do something that's very radical that the Lord's been developing in Daniel's heart, and we're going to take the youth of this ministry out to the MTC, and they've got some great things planned to seed them for missions, to begin to help them understand how to take a hold of taking a nation, to begin to cast a vision for them of going to the unreached people groups. And we're just going to see that, you know, expand to churches everywhere so that we can influence more people, more young people, to see for themselves a lifetime of ministry on the mission field, wherever they are at. Whether they're in the United States of America or United Kingdom, wherever. Whether they're in college or junior high school, or whether midlife in business, to see that the Lord's now, I've got a vision for the Lord to promote me now, to begin to flow and function in the realms of ministry, to go everywhere preaching the gospel, representing heaven. I believe if you don't have a vision, you're going to perish. I believe if you don't have a vision, you're going to continually be tossed by every wind of doctrine. You're going to be continually in an uproar. And somebody said, what kind of vision do I need to have? The one that Jesus had, the one that the Lord gave to us. The command that He said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. Somebody said, well, that's not for all of us. Yeah, it's for all of us. Yeah. It's just as much for all of us as he that calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. In the same context, on the same pages of the Bible. Begin to get yourself a vision for how God's going to use you. As you do, you'll understand if you're going to go, you're going to have to have something to go with. If you're going to be a part of ministry, listen, people, I didn't have anybody shove me out the door and tell me I need to go do this, go do that. I was compelled by the love of God. The love of God compels us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want everybody to stand with me. Revival does not tarry for the lack of people praying and fasting. Because you only need one person really praying and fasting. God will do great things for the sake of one man. And it's a good thing, because usually it's been one man. In most generations, it's not been a whole crew of people. Oh yeah, the churches have been filled in all generations, but there's been one or two men. Oh, everybody said they equally knew God and everybody had their opinion. Boy, they were stout concerning what they believed, but there was only one or two men. And God did lots of things for one or two men. Revival doesn't languish because of the lack of men fasting and praying, though there need to be more fasting and praying. The revival tarries only for one reason: the lack of participation. Reinhardt just started. He just took it to another level. He invited a host of different people that applied to come last week to his mentoring session to raise up evangelists to go everywhere in the United States of America and the different nations of the world that God graces us to go. But he himself is taking up a banner. He's hitting all the major cities. He'll be in Miami this next month. I know he's in New York in November. God's stirring things. He's packing the places out. There's a great void for the men of God and the women of God. There's a great void for those who know how to stand in the place of Jesus Christ and present the gospel that Jesus described for us to present. There's a great void. Father's looking at your life and he's purposed for you to go. He's not withheld any good thing from you. He's not said you can't be a part of this. You're left out. You're not good enough. You're not talented enough. I love Catherine Coleman. She said, I have nothing. I have no talents. I can't sing. I can't play an instrument. I'm an ugly duckling. I have nothing. I'm not impressive. I'm not charismatic. No one has ever been in any way thrilled by my person. But one day I said to Jesus, Jesus, all I have to give you is my heart, and I give it to you. All I have to give you is my heart, and I give it all to you. I won't hold any of it back. I won't hold any of it back for myself. I won't hold any of it back to have my own house. I won't hold any of it back to have my own husband. I won't hold any of it back to have my own clothing, to have anything. I won't hold anything of my heart back. I'll make you all my treasure. I'll live only for you. I won't want anything in this life but you. Take my heart, Jesus, and fill me with everything that you are. And the Lord gave her that exchange, and we saw it. And God raised up great ministries. Her generation, she stood as a Deborah for her generation. I see the same opportunity for Deborah standing back there, Deborah Graham. The opportunity is there for everybody. I can just, sometimes we see it because there's a bit more willingness. We'll point it out, there's a bit more willingness. It's not that the Lord's saying, I'm just going to give it to this one and that one and just a few. No, he sees the willingness. I'll do this with you. I see the willingness. I see the abandonment. I see your willingness to be totally abandoned. But the beautiful thing of it is the Lord will change all of our hearts. And that's a good thing. He said, I'm going to go find a man after my own heart. You know how he got a man after his own heart? He found somebody who would allow him to give him a new heart. David allowed God to give him a new heart. You know why David had a heart after the heart of the Lord? Because the Lord gave him a new heart. Just like he gave Saul. The Spirit of the Lord came upon him and he had a new heart. And he had a heart after the Father. The Lord said, no one's left out. Just where are you? The moment you're going to get words of God coming to you, prophecy is going to come to you, is the moments where you're broken. It's the moments where you're broken with total abandonment. Faith begins to be activated in your life and you say, Lord, I don't care. I'm here. I'll do anything. I'll go anywhere. Something begins to happen. And then the word of the Lord is going to come to you, and anybody who flows in prophecy, anybody who flows in word of knowledge, that the words are going to come to you. But what if you got, I want to be this, and I want to go here, and I want to do this, and I want to have that? Then your heart's filled with other things. Misunderstand that. And we want to have a mansion on a hill, and or we want to have a cabin in the woods. Or Ann and I will start talking about stuff like this. You know, what are we going to do when we get to be 80? Because I told her, I said, when I first met my wife, I said, I'll be your old great-grandpa if you be my old great-grandma. And now we're going for great-great-grandpa. Not just great-great, we're going for great-great-great-grandpa and great-great-great-great-grandma kind of thing, you know. And we just thought, well, you know, because we love the woods. We love being in the mountains. And we'll talk about it, and then we'll go, Father, that doesn't compare to being used by you. Let us stand upon the platforms of the world and announce the good news of Jesus Christ and present your signs, wonders, and miracles for the rest of our life. And then we can just die on the platform and go right up into heaven. Angels are going to come for me. Jesus is going to come for me. He promised it to me, and I hold him to his promise, and I want you to have the same promise for yourself. Jesus said, I go away to prepare a place for you, and if it were not so, I would not have told you. If I go away to prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you into myself, that where I am, you may be there also. That's what he's going to do. Jesus is coming for me. Is Jesus coming for you? And I'm not having to wait to the catching away necessarily for Jesus to come. Because tonight, I might be caught away. My heart's more in heaven than it is in home, here. I've watched as men. I've always been in admiration of men who preach out of heaven. They preach out of heaven, minister out of heaven. And I'm dedicated to having that. You know how you know someone's ministering out of heaven? Because you can feel heaven when they talk. Don't you want that? Yes. Father wants that for you. It's yours. But your heart's got to let go of all the other stuff. So what are you going to hold on to tonight? Houses, land, your money, your security. Could you give it all?
Yes.
Do you get a little queasy? Are you ready to resign your job in the morning? It's a little queasy feeling, eh? A little queasy when you get serious with it, a little queasy. Oh, well, that was just for last night during the move of God. Not really. We're not going to do that, right? We're not going to do that. Praise God for women who will stand with men. Say, no, we'll do that. We're ready to go. God showed us what to do. We're going. We're going to live for Him. We're going to fully live for Jesus. Now, the last thing we want you to do is go to the ends of the earth without an anointing. Why don't you go there with signs, wonders, and miracles? The ability to preach and communicate the gospel. And that's why we minister, because as we minister, those who hook up with us, the same anointing that is in my life, that is in our life, is transferred to you so that you can preach out of the same gift. Wow. And this ministry now is a gift. No pressure. Honestly, I went home and watched the U.S. Open and fell asleep watching the U.S. Open. I've got an anointing. I carry something. I can fall asleep watching the U.S. Open and get up out of that chair and walk right over into the realms of ministry. Speak out of heaven. Hallelujah. Karastorimaya. Linga namoshi peketeya. But I'm not going to go get involved in a bunch of nonsense. I'm not going to get involved in a bunch of religion. Huh? Now I'm going to get involved in a bunch of doubt and unbelief, trying to work it all out and figure it all out and think I'm going to have something from heaven. Now I'm going to go get involved in a bunch of lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, and pride of life. I'm at war. You're at war. People think that the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life are just natural, ordinary opportunities. They're not natural, ordinary opportunities. It's a demonic assignment against your soul to destroy you. It's the powers of darkness ready to take possession of your life. It's the fleshly lust at war against your soul that Peter described. If you don't know how to fight, you better learn. And the weapons of your warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God. Hallelujah. And you can be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His might, so that you might take unto yourself the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against all the wiles of the wicked. And it's no problem when it's a love thing going on. I'm so filled up with this love. I do whatever you want me to do. Father, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I just want you to say that tonight in your heart. You don't even have to say it with your lips necessarily. You can. But I want you to say it with abandonment. I want you to say it like I say it. I don't want a house. I don't need a house. I don't need clothing. I don't need food. I don't need a car. I don't need anything. All I need is you. All I want is you. And I know you'll provide everything that I have need of that you want me to have. This is my crucible. This is my crucible. It's true. This is my fire furnace, faith, where the Lord tries me. These are my deep waters, where He perfects me. Are you in yours? Where He's preparing me. Father, stirring good things up. My dear friend, Brother Yun, will be here on October the 5th. Make sure you make note of that. He'll be here with us for Sunday morning. Might stay longer, who knows. Some great things happening there. Great things. God has given us a great company of mighty men to stand among. That love this church, that love this place, that love the anointing here, that love the call. To love the divine authority that's been given to us. We pray that you will love it too. That you may fully benefit from those things that the Spirit of the Lord has purposed flow into you. I can see the nations of the earth being touched by the sound of heaven, by the working of divine grace flowing out of this place. Why? Because I'm willing. Why? Because you're willing. Why? Because you're desperate. Why? Because you want to more than anything else. When everybody else is planning other things, you're just planning how to live for Jesus' name. You're just planning how to bring Him glory and honor. This is the Father's heart. He wants to glorify Jesus. Can you imagine what would happen if you understood exactly what Father is doing and begin to do it with Him? Huh? As you go to Finland? Yes. And as God opens up doors for you?
Yes.
And with fire and authority, you yes. speak?
Yes.
With fire and love and faith, you move. Yes. Signs and wonders take yes. place.
Yes.
The gift of God flows out of you. Thank you, Jesus. Be happy that the Lord doesn't let you have too much attachment to other things. Be happy that nothing really works for you but the kingdom of God. You should be happy about that. The Lord is going to make sure that you don't get spoiled. When are you guys going to Finland? When are you leaving?
The 27th.
27th of July?
June.
June. God! Father! In the name of Jesus, magnify your son. And Angelo and Paulina, because that's all they want. They don't have room in their heart for anything else. I tell you right now, I know this about them. They not looking for a house and a car and a job and fame. And they just want to give honor to Jesus' name. When you give your heart to the Father in that condition, He'll fill every room of your life. He is no respecter of persons. One day Michael said to me, Michael Francine, And it was a time where he was one of the biggest ministries on the planet. God done more through him than any man. T.L. Osborne says he's the Apostle Paul of our generation. And he said, Mark, I found one thing in God. If he did it for somebody else, he'll do it for me. All I got to say is, I want that. If you can find it in the Bible anywhere where God did it for somebody else, that is your right to access it. That didn't fall on any deaf ears around here. That's mine now. If Elijah did it, I'll do it too. If Enoch did it, I'll do it. Hallelujah. If Paul did it, I'll do it. If Jesus did it, I'll do it. He's determined it so. And then the Lord took it after that. He said, I'll take it to another realm for you. But you know what? You're going to have to get the first realm first. Doing those things that everybody else has already done, laying claim to it, that God would do it through you as well. Then he says, I'll cause you to do greater works. It's like I see some people, they set the high water mark so high that they just never do anything. They're just overwhelmed before they even get started because they're thinking, well, greater works. Why don't you just start worshiping him? Why don't you wake up in the morning and say, Holy Spirit, I know you're here. And I'm going to follow you and I'm going to be led by you. And I'm going to learn how to walk in the mind of the Spirit. I'm going to learn how to think according to your way and your thinking and your plan instead of all my logic and all my reasoning and all my ideas. And you know what actually has more impact on people than even logic and reasoning? You know what has more impact on people than that? Imaginations. Imaginations. Somebody didn't return your email 2 days and you already got them hating you, wondering what it was you did wrong. Hey, they out of the country, man. They can't even get the email. They ain't even seen the email. Imagination will stop you. Imaginations. Creating the most negative scenarios against you and God, against you and other people. Nah. I bring into captivity every thought. I cast down imaginations. Imaginations will keep you from your divine opportunity. It'll keep you from moving God with God. It'll keep you from making the right decisions. It'll cause you to make wrong moves. It will keep you and prevent you from walking in wisdom. Imaginations run wild. Dear people, wake up in the morning to the Holy Ghost. Wake up in the morning. Wake up tomorrow morning, Christina. With the Holy Ghost telling you, girl, I'm going to make something out of you that you can't even begin to imagine. And you're going to get a little taste of it here. And then when you get into eternity, you're going to see it stretched out before you. Age without end. A divine purpose and plan. Just giving. Just start living. Now just start living. Get out of your prison. Get out of your prison of human effort and human success of the American nightmare. Get out of it. House and tree is contentment to me. God forbid. Bind it in Jesus' name. Doing the will of the Father is everything.
There's no room in my heart for anything but Jesus. He occupies, he fills every place, my desire, all I need, all I want. Lord, you're all I need. Lord, you're all I need. Oh, Lord Jesus, you're all I need. Oh, Lord, you're all I need. Oh, Lord, you're all I need. Lord Jesus, you're all I need. Your blood has cleansed me now. Your blood cleanses me. Your blood, it cleanses me. Lord Jesus, you're all I need. Your blood cleanses. Rabba Yidoyo, your blood cleanses me. Lord Jesus, you're all I need. All I need. Right now, in Jesus' name, take your heart, your whole heart, which are your affections, which are the things that you trust in, which are the things that you feel that you need, which are the things that you hold on to dearly, that you must have. It's what you spend your money on. It's where you find your security. It's where you find the value and meaning of your life. And I want you to let it all go. I want you to take it and bring it to an altar. And I want you to put it on an altar and offer it to Jesus now. Offer it to him. Let it all get burned up. Give it all to him. The last time that I was ministering to you last Sunday night, I ministered to you about how the Lord Jesus asked different things of different people based on where they were. To Matthew, all he needed to do was leave the life of living a riotous life full of pleasure to come follow Jesus. That's all he needed to do. Let's get up. Leave the riotous life, spending all of his money on parties at night. Rich man, his heart was all bound up by his riches, by the securities, by his title, his place. Jesus said, get rid of it. My title, my birthright, my title, my wealth, all of it, all of it. It keeps your heart. Jesus was saying this. It keeps your heart from surrendering to a bigger and better plan. Come follow me. His mouth said, what must I do to enter into the kingdom? Jesus said, what does the law say? He spoke it out. Jesus spoke it out for him. And he said, these things have I done from my youth. Jesus said, you lack one thing. Your heart's not surrendered. Your heart's filled with those things which you possess. Go take it, sell it, give it to the poor. So it's not in your heart anymore. Come follow me. Those of you who are going to get up and go to a job in the morning, do it to the Lord. It's a mission field. Put the Lord first. Don't put your work first. If your job demands you to leave off seeking God,
there's something seriously wrong, because then your job is for you, it's not for the kingdom. People used to tell me all the time, oh, well, you know, you shouldn't you be concerned about your children, because when they were, you know, growing and 10, 11, 12, 13 years old, the boys, we were in meetings almost every night. And the boys and also the girls, but especially the boys, they wanted to be right in the big involvement of everything, you know, directing traffic and parking cars and whatnot, big meetings we're having. They were up to 1, 2 o'clock in the morning. They made good grades. They didn't get sick. And they walked with God. Why? We kept the kingdom first, not the job. The job didn't tell us when we were going to go home. Huh? Huh? Look at all the great revivals. We're talking about people who stayed captivated by the presence of the Lord till late at night. And when you're in the big move, when you're in the big move of revival, when you're in the big move of the harvest, my goodness gracious. Imagine that there was 1,000, imagine that there was 100 people coming to the kingdom every day. Or just imagine there was 100 people coming to the kingdom once a week that just weren't coming in, you know, and then never coming back. They were giving their life to the Lord, and now they're going to be processed and planted. That's a lot of work for people to do. Now take it to 1,000. Now you're working all day long for the master. There's no time for anything else. You're working till late in the night taking care of God's sheep, God's people. How about if it goes to a level where it's really a sweeping, massive move of God and tens of thousands of people coming into the kingdom per day? And you're going to go home because you need to get sleep for your job? Your mind will play tricks on you. You better make sure that you submit all the stuff that you're going to do to the Lord. Say, Lord, here's what I plan on doing. Are you good with that? See what he said. He helps sort it out, whether it's a decision made in heaven or not. Tonight, Father's asking you to give all your heart to him. Tonight, he's asking you to vacate all the other rooms of your heart and of your life that was occupied by other things. I heard Reinhardt preach a sermon one night, and it was a visitation he had from the Lord, where he saw the lives of many of God's people. And when the Lord would come over to visit, they would allow him to come into the living room. And there was only one place of their life that he was allowed to occupy, and it was their living room. All the rest of the rooms of the house, and it was a huge mansion, belonged to them. He was never allowed to move in, because they had so many other interests and so many other purposes, so many other things of value. Tonight, the Lord's asking you to surrender your heart to him. If you can say tonight you have surrendered your heart to him, amen. Praise God. Now grow and mature and develop in that wonderful love relationship that will produce faith in your life, a trust, a total abandonment, where you'll do anything, go anywhere, be anything he wants you to be. I took Rodney skiing one day, and it was when he was overweight. And I hope he's not watching. I hope he doesn't see this. You can edit this part out. It doesn't really matter. But at any rate, the boots were tight on him because his legs were a little big, a lot big. And I had him up on the side of a mountain at Squaw Valley. And he said, Lord, if you'll get me off the side of this mountain. And I got to see how he lived all of his life. This is how he lived his life. Lord, get me off the side of this mountain, and I'll go anywhere. I'll do anything.
I'll say anything. I'll be anything you want me to be, because it was a threatening situation. You know, I'm a little bit, sometimes not as thoughtful as I ought to be, and took him a little bit to a little too steep a place, a little too high on the mountain. But that's the way you live your life. Lord, I'll go anywhere you want me to go. I'll do, and it's always about that. And I've seen that in so many different people that have been used by the Lord. It's always about, Lord, I'll go anywhere you want me to go. I'll be anything you want me to be. I'll do anything you want me to do. Here I am. Just move me to that next spot. Just get me to that next place. I'll trust you all the way. I'm so blessed. I'm so honored by what Rodney's doing right now. And as he's taking, which everyone should call Rodney, Pastor Rodney, or Dr. Rodney Howard Brown, or Brother Rodney, honor him. We've been friends a long time, and for me, it's just always been that. It's always been my dear brother Rodney, put it that way. Doing Dark Constitution Hall. It's probably going to cost, $2 million. He didn't start with one penny of it. Guarantee you, he did not start with one penny of the $2 million. He's a prisoner of love. He's no different from you, anyone. By birth, no different. He just stepped into a faith that functions by love. He stepped into a realm of obeying all that the Lord has commanded. And the Lord said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. That's the big it. That's the big thing. And that motivation you can begin to move in to this faith. What a privilege, what a blessing to have people that are shaking it up and moving forward. Do you want to get in the mix? Would you like to shake it up? Would you like to start shaking things up and moving forward? Let all of your affections and all of your heart and all of your vision, all of your ambitions, all of your entitlement, be all in Jesus. Let everything else be dung. Let everything else be dung. Let everything else be nothing, meaningless. Worse than nothing. Worse than nothing. Worse than meaningless. Worse than of no value. Let everything about your life become disdained. It's disdaining. And reality of it is, when Paul said, I count it all as dung, he was really saying exactly what Jesus said when he said, you must hate your life in this world. You must hate your life in this world if you're going to have the life that I have for you. Businessmen, businesswomen, you make your business about the kingdom of God. You make it about it, not late, not later, now. Not giving someday, giving now. Not advertising the gospel and ministering the gospel of Jesus someday, now. Now, right now, today, tonight. Make your business, consecrate your business as you're consecrating your heart. Because I'm not pointing out to you different people here tonight saying, quit your job, leave, go to the mission field right now. I'm telling you, get the stuff out of your heart. I'm telling you, put it on the altar tonight. I'm asking you to give it to the Lord such to the point that He can take it from you. And that you're not going to be upset. We lost our house. What's going on? If we had the blessing of the Lord, how would we have lost our house? Oh, I thought you gave it to Him the other day. What are you talking about now? Do you hear what I'm saying? I heard you say, Lord, I give it to you. It's yours. And if there's anything else in your life that steals your joy, that stops the praise, that stops the thanksgiving, that stops or hinders the flow
of the glory of God in your life, get rid of it. Get rid of it. Don't allow it to have such a place of influence anymore. Don't allow it to have such a place of influence. People say, happy wife, happy life. Not so. It helps. It's nice that I'm blessed that way, but it's not so. Holy Spirit, new creation. Faith that works by love, happy life. Jesus, occupying every room of my affections and every room of my desire, happy life. No earthly attachments. No earthly attachments. Let your fire burn in me, God. Well, I want to give everybody tonight an opportunity to worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings. You know, you've just been worshiping the Lord with surrendering your whole heart to Him, surrendering your whole life to Him, getting everything right in your life. Now, I just want you to just place the Lord first in your finances. Thank you, Jesus. You know, I feel great change taking place. I feel resolve taking place in people's life. There's not a reason that every woman in here can't do exactly what Catherine Coleman did. My wife has done it. Anna's done it. I know what she's expecting to do. I know what she's going to do. I know she's going to stand upon the platforms of this world and see great signs and wonders. Great exploits in God. Because Jesus got her whole heart. She doesn't own a house. She doesn't have a bunch of affections and attachments to anything except for me, right? And I'm on the altar, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Amen?
Amen.
And now you finally got to the place that if I am taken up into heaven, you're going to go right on in ministry, right? Because you're going to do what God's called you to do. Isn't that correct? Huh? You're not fully there yet tonight? She's saying, no, I'm going to raise you from the dead. You're not going anywhere. You're not messing with my faith. She's already telling me, you're not messing with my faith. Don't mess with my faith. Hallelujah. Is anyone in here with any sickness or disease and you want to be healed? There are some people with sicknesses and disease who don't want to be healed. It's true. And I mean, I've had a person say, you know, if I get healed, does that mean I've got to report it to Social Security? Because I live off the check. Yes. You must report it. Well, I don't want to be healed then. Then there's a category of people that they're not going to press in to be healed because they just resign it that, well, this is God's will for my life. When there's not a verse of scripture in the Bible that says that any sickness or disease is God's will for your life. They say, well, what about Job? Well, I'll tell you right now, Job got healed. And he got everything restored. Come here, I want to pray for you. I want to pray for you. And is it your girlfriend? Right? You. I want to pray for you and your girlfriend, correct? Come here. Come here. Now it's good to see you here. God's got a call on your life. You know that. It's inescapable. You're just going to start doing what's right. Yeah. It's just the way it works, man. You know, the destiny, the purpose that's on your life. I'm sorry I forgot your name.
Jesse.
The destiny and purpose on your life is so much bigger than what you live in. Are you in love with this girl? Why don't you marry her?
We're trying.
You're working on that? And you're from Japan?
Yeah.
And your name is?
Sumi.
Well, right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, I destroy every yoke from off your life. Everything that'll keep you back from heaven. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I set you free from all the strongholds of darkness, of generations of imprisonment to sin and death. I set you free. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, I give you a new heart and I give you a new spirit, says the Lord. And I break off all the former things. I break off all the lies and the deceptions so that you can know what it means to live. Father, in Jesus' name, we're anointing right now. The anointing of the Holy Ghost. Father, I ask you now in Jesus' name and in your mercy and your grace, make everything about this life right and conformed to your will, to your ways. Father, I thank you right now in Jesus' name for spiritual healing. Right now in the name of Jesus, I put the blood of Jesus Christ upon you and I break off every yoke and every stronghold of the enemy and just try to fix itself to you and keep you, try to hold you back from enjoying the things that Father's freely given. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. Let tonight be the night of radical change. Fire your presence, Lord. Fire your presence. Jesus. 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 Is there anyone else in here? You want to surrender your life to the Lord tonight? You want Father to touch you? Change to come? Sickness in your body, in your heart. Troubled soul. Can't think right. Can't sleep right. Can't act right. Liberation is so free and so easy. Father's given us the ability to announce it. Dealing with depression. Dealing with sorrow. Anything of those categories. Depression, sorrow, affliction, torment of soul and mind. Come, let's break it off. Come, let's bring it to an end. Let's come to an end with you. That's right. A lifelong strongholds come to an end by the power that is in the name of Jesus. Beautiful. He gave you beauty for ashes. He gave you the oil of joy for mourning. He gave you the garment of praise. for the spirit of heaviness. You're a tree of righteousness. You're the planting of the Lord. And Jesus Christ is glorified by it. Beautiful. I tell you right now, I would do ministry in San Diego in the Abiding Place ministry if it was nothing for no one else but Crystal. Just seeing people established, growing, maturing, strongholds of the enemy being broken off. Satan need no longer ruin your life. Plant yourself in the house of God. Lay hold on the things of God. Don't let go until everything that He's promised is realized in your life. Because God will not lie, cannot lie. What He said He'll do, He'll do. He's faithful to perform it. Just get planted. Get planted. I used to sing, "I'm a young and tender olive tree planted in the house of the Lord." Now I sing, "I'm a great big oak tree planted by the rivers of the Lord." Hallelujah. But you start there at the beginning. Don't despise the time of beginning. Don't despise the day of the beginning. It's beautiful. We're going to go, grandbaby's going to be born Tuesday morning at 8 o'clock. And you don't think we're going to be excited about that beginning? That new light, that beginning, that little small thing that won't recognize any of us? But we will recognize her and love her dearly from the day, the moment that even before we've seen her. Hallelujah. Be happy about the beginning you have in God. There are those tonight, you've left your first love. And you've not known how to get it back. There is an encounter with God that will only take place under the desperation of your heart. Listen, I've been allowed to be around a lot of ministries, and I've watched as there may be 5,000 people in the building, but only 50 to 500 people are touched. 50 to 500. 5,000 in the building, but only 50 to 500 people are touched. Literally, 1 to 10%. That's it. And asking the Lord many times, "Lord, why? Why is this so limited?" It's the state of the heart, the hunger of the heart, the condition of the heart. When your heart's not filled and jammed full of all this other stuff, it's just all emptied out just for Him to fill it. Ooh. That's how you go back to your first love. Church at Ephesus is a powerful testimony to the church today. Boy, they had everything right when it came to doctrine. Oh. Boy, are their discernment, they could try those who said they were apostles and were not. Oh. Boy, they had it all put together. But they didn't have the love. They didn't have that love. All that matters to God, He's not interested in your religion, your works, all the things that you've done or haven't done. Faith that works by love. A trust and abandonment to go and do the impossible that only happens because you're in love. I'm not letting you go too easily tonight. I want you, every one of you, to be resolved to these things. If you fail, resign yourself to success. Give yourself no rest. If I do something and it doesn't work, I'm telling you, I can't even sleep at night. I got to get the thing done. I got to get it right. Because I resolve myself to this. Every area of my life, especially spiritually, I want you to come follow me. Because this works. No failure mentality. No give up mentality. There's no give up. There's no failure. There's none that stops you. You just get up and go. We're going to do this thing. We're going to get it done. Let's do it now. I want you to, when you hear preachers preaching, I want you to say, no matter how lofty it is, no matter how big it is, no matter how grandiose it is, say, that's me. That's what I'm going to do. That right there. I'm going to do that too. Hallelujah. I'm there. I'm with you. Let's do this thing. Watch Pastor Kelly. He's on it. We're doing it. I'm there. Now. Not going to stop. I love it. He's been through a lot of challenges. You can see that none of it was, had his heart. Jesus had his heart. Does Jesus have your heart? If he doesn't, give it all to him tonight. Don't walk out of this place holding part of your heart for yourself. Demands that you place upon God for yourself. Don't do that. Don't limit God in your life. What's up, Dwayne? Okay, well, we can take care of that, not a problem. Father, I thank you that Dwayne is going to surrender everything here to you tonight. Everything. Everything. The good job. The fine. Judicial degree. From a good law school. All of it. All of it. So nothing can hold him back from living a consecrated life for you, to living to glorify the Son. Come here, buddy. Come here. You're fine. Don't walk by sight, walk by faith. Don't be influenced by fear. My dear son Joshua, we moved out to Ramona and built a little house out there, and for some reason or other, we ended up building the house right on a scorpion mound or something, because we just had scorpion infestation for a while. And a scorpion hit my son right in the face. Still got a little bit of a scar there when he was sleeping. And his lymph nodes, his glands, everything swelled up and looked pretty bad. And kind of bad where you kind of, you know, you need to hospitalize. And you know what? I live in a realm of peace. And so we didn't have worry. And so we were able to say, you're fine, son. And we watched as it took a while. It took quite a while for those swollen glands. I mean, it looked like he had the mumps for a while. Go down. It never touched us. It couldn't access us. You know, fear couldn't access us. You know why? We had a cloud of peace around us. Said, but why couldn't you sit back and think about it logically? Because I just couldn't. Because I thought about it spiritually. I thought about it through the mind of Christ and the mind of God, the mind of the Spirit, who said he's healed. Eh? See, there's no fear in love. And all that matters to Father is faith that works by love. That's all he was interested in. For without faith, it's impossible to please him. Benjamin, when you say to the Lord, when you say, Lord, I'll go anywhere, I'll do anything, I'll be anything, I'll say anything that you want me to be, you want me to do, you want me to say, you give it all to him. You don't hold anything back. It's his. It's his. It's his. It's his. Hallelujah. Then you can wake up in the morning and say, Lord, I'm living for you. And it's true. And he responds to truth. He says, yeah, you are. You're living for me. Look what I'm going to do for you now. Look what I'm going to do for you now. You taking everything to build my house? Look, I'm going to build you a house. The only house I'm really interested in the Lord building me is the one that's over in Glory Land. Just over in the Glory Land, there with the mighty host I stand. Just over in the Glory Land. Thank you, Jesus. Jacob, what do you need? Huh? You don't really sleep well? Well, you know what's going to happen to you tonight, my little friend? You're going to start sleeping well. You know why? Because Jesus is going to touch you. Pastor's going to pray, okay? Jesus is going to touch you. You're going to start sleeping well. And everything's going to work right. How's that? Now, Jacob. Here's what's happening. I'm giving you my peace. I sleep really good, and then I give you my peace. You sleep good too. Mm-hmm. What's up?
I came in here and like just a fever,
and
I feel like
90% better. That's spirit of affliction messing with you, spirit of sickness. 90% of it's gone. Oh, it's gone now. It's all gone now. Si gado kasi ana na. Ikara sara niya sa kaniya kada na kada kasi ana kada kano. Si ana nga si ana. Gone. Strengthened. Sickness can't stand in the anointing. Please. If I feel any sickness come on me, I'll pray in the Holy Ghost till it goes. And do the same thing with worry, concern. You do the same thing too. Ibrava basiki rebe bebe bebe no fatai. Bebreve shikara bobo bobo susa di difi. Yes, susirum. Esudaman. Esudaman. Sudamanga. You been feeling sick? How are you tonight?
Surrender, love for God, love for others.
Thank you, Jesus. For filling up your servant's heart with love for you more than can be contained. Out of your belly flows rivers of the Holy Ghost. Right now in the name of Jesus, be baptized. Be baptized in the presence of the Spirit of the Lord.
be filled up so that out of your belly begins to flow these expressions of divine power and grace. That just like on the day of Pentecost, the same thing that happened to them also happens to you. The Spirit of the Lord comes upon you like a mighty rushing wind. And the power of God begins to rest upon you like clothed in tongues of fire. Out of your belly. Out of your innermost being. Ha! Rabasikina no moshikaina. La sana boka shikarataini. Shikandrustaina. Shikandorumatuini. Shikandopukunayana. Shikainamokuringadayanaya. Halimashikaina mokupoyanaya. There it is. There it is. Sikainam painolomosutina. Shikainamongalaya. Siberanai. Oh, tikiye de siti.
What's up? What's up? What's up? What's up? What's up? No affliction, no torment in Jesus' name. Don't agree with wrong things that'll mess you up. Don't agree with wrong things that will mess you up. Only agree with right things. Only agree with the truth. Only agree with the word of the Lord. Jesus, Jesus. Right now, in Jesus' name. Right now, in Jesus' name. Right now, in Jesus' name. You're going to trust like never before. You're going to believe like never before. You're going to accept like never before those things which God has said. Now, in Jesus' name. Now, in Jesus' name. Right through you. Right now, in Jesus' name. Rebostol. Rebaste berene. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Berasana. Berasitala no monkade. Berasito rinenkasa. Right now in Jesus' name. Receive. Resando. Resedea. Receive. Vibredasea. Receive. Now in Jesus' name. Now I break the yoke of everything that would hinder you and hold you back. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ.
Straighten out that toe, it hurts when I walk.
Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ. You just push that thing right back into place. Father, thank you for your fire. Thank you for your fire. I don't need to have a discussion with him. I'll just pray. Sikoros tahabe, mombrosite, morosifi, molombate, monsid. Now, come in, don't fall down on me. Nisipai. Nisipere, nisipere susta, membresitia. Now, you let go of these things that hold you back now. Don't harbor these things in your spirit. Don't harbor these things in your spirit. Now, come on. Now, you listen to me. Don't harbor these things in your spirit. Don't harbor these things in your spirit now in Jesus' name. Now, you just let it go. Just let it go. Just let them go. Let these things go right now. Let these things go right now. Let them go. Let them go. Yeah. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go.
Somebody said, well, how can I do it? Miracle. Miracle. Minister says, let him go. You say, yes. Miracle takes place.
Fire, God, right now in Jesus' name. Mezadula, Membrusatai, Monksatia, Mamblusatan, Membrusikisha, Mamblusataya, Membrusikisha, Membrevatist, Malomadai, Malomade. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. She's back. Moshikai. Hallelujah. Marishan. Pana, sepere.
Is that what you call a catch? That's all right.
Shibara, ishipori, ishiporanase, mangleo, mangaletea, mangalisipurudai, merede, meredea, 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 muradaya, muradaya, masatea, muradaya, muradaya, muradasatai, muradaya sikatai, muradaya sikataya, muradaya shikapia to, muradaya. Murasaradeya, 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 Hallelujah, Murasaradeya, Hallelujah, Hallelujah, Murasaradeya Pekadai. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Murama Makate. Huh. Who? Oh, Rabba Baba. Who? 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 Ha ha. Birusha. Who? Mengadea. Mengadea. Father, I thank you for your anointing upon your servant Heather. Isirafu yatwirasaya repekia. Tirasu taranega. Sirapapre. Pyre. Fiery, passionate authority, fiery, passionate authority that just will not be denied. This is the way it's going to be, and it can't be any other way. Fiery, passionate authority. Michael Fisher, you know, the Lord will open up your ears. He'll open up your ears. Now, it really won't take much on your part. A dear friend of mine, and I'm pretty sure John's watching tonight. He just did a big crusade, you know, in Central America. And as he was walking out, God had done a lot of signs and wonders, but as he was walking out, they brought this deaf girl to him. And she was rebellious and defiant and didn't want to be there. And almost like sticking her tongue out at him. She's a rebellious little Hispanic girl who just was deaf. So he started praying for her. And commanding her ears to open, and nothing happened. And she's leaving. The newspapers had been there, the radio, I mean, just signs of wonders, miracles, everything. And the powers of darkness is trying to invalidate the meeting. He's like, set him up where he can't exit. He's trying to exit, and he can't exit because there's this girl, and she's defiant. And he says, he puts his fingers in her ears. He said, I command you to hear now in Jesus' name. Open. And she just defiantly said, he said to the translator, can you hear? And she just defiantly threw her head around. No, shaking her head, no, I can't hear nothing. And the Spirit of the Lord said, whatever you do, do not stop praying. 30 minutes later, people are staying watching this thing go on. 30 minutes. 30 minutes.
This is not hype and circumstance. Because that's not what you do, because you keep processing everybody through and get, you know, okay, you didn't get really healed yet. We don't, you'll be a lull here. We're trying to keep a high. Whatever you do, no, no, let go. And every time he asked her, can you hear now? She just became more indignant and more defiant and more just, I don't want to be here, and this repulsive, angry look. And he would not let her go. 30 minutes later, all of a sudden, her ears popped open, her eyes flooded with tears. She broke, she collapsed, she heard. And of course, when a person's been deaf and they hear, every sound is extreme. You know, you have to put your hands over your ears. It doesn't take much to get healed. Don't take much faith to get healed. And so, you hear me, Michael? You hear me? You hear me? You hear me? I'm talking about your spirit hearing me. I don't care if you hear through the sign language or what. I'm talking about you hearing me. I'm sick and tired of you having to have a translator. It's bugging me. I mean, we love you, but it's bugging me. It's bugging me because it doesn't need to be. I don't like deaf. I don't like this. I don't like a person sitting in a meeting, deaf, saying that Jesus doesn't heal. He commanded us to preach the gospel, to open up the ears of the deaf. There was a guy, I think he might have come with you from Calvary Chapel. And I saw the Lord was going to heal him. And I went and I grabbed him. And I began to declare, be healed right now. And I felt the healing anointing. But, I mean, he's a good man. He loves the Lord. He's ministering to other deaf people. But he's just content to be deaf. I'm not content to leave him deaf. So what's going to happen to you one night? Michael, I'm going to tell you what's going to happen to you one night. One night you're going to come in here and I'm going to be so provoked that I'm going to tackle you. And I'm going to hold you down until you hear. Because it's my job, my job, it's my job. I take my job seriously. If I fail, I resolve myself to success. Are you with me now? Whatever you do, don't stop praying. And Johnny's just tenacious enough. He don't care about the rumbling of the crowd. He don't care. He don't care about the rumbling of opinions around him. God says something, he's going to do it. Come on, man. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whatever you do, don't stop praying. Amen. And I say that to you because what God says to one person, he says to every person. Whatever you do, don't stop praying. Don't let it go. Don't let it go. Don't let it go. Don't let it go. Whatever you believe in God for, don't let it go. Don't stop. Don't let it go. Don't settle for less. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost here in this life. In Jesus' name, I put the blessing of the Lord on your tender heart. Now, in Jesus' name. This is good missionary material here. Now, Father, I just thank you for your baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire. Father, I thank you for the authority and power to be a witness unto you and to the authority of your resurrection. Every room of your heart now occupied by nothing but Jesus. Only Jesus. In Jesus' name, from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, speak life and strength and healing. Now in Jesus' name, life and strength and healing. Now in Jesus' name. Every good and perfect thing. Right now in Jesus' name, I command a blessing upon you.
I command you to be blessed. Right out of your belly flows rivers of the Spirit. Right out of your belly, just like on the day of Pentecost, suddenly they all began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Spirit gave them utterance. Zarakayatai, nothing has changed. Religion tries to stop it. The power of men's opinion prevent it. But the power of the Holy Ghost will not let them. Ha! Zikatayaraba, ziaraba, jiromona. Change in Jesus' name. Change in Jesus' name. That healing change. That glorious change. In Jesus' name. Right out of your belly flows these rivers of the Holy Ghost. Derana siye tekeya. Barana sikia tia dadaya. Ha. Beto, Yeriseto, Magasadatea. Ha 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 ha. Mandere, Mananandea, Manamuzai, Mengji Prushepra, Mungi Blasite, Brista, Bristipere, Briste, Bristiperatoya, Bristiperanaya, Briste, Menosikea, Mahatate, Lanania Tea, Malatea Nea Nea Tea Late. Malataya niya saya hayata. Malataya nakate. Put your hands towards heaven. Sandra, come here. You and your husband. And your children's. So you got your dad a t-shirt that says dad against daughters dating, huh? I like that t-shirt. I need one. Soramona naya taya. Soramona taya meya. Solomon, just put your hands towards heaven. Whole family, baptized in the Holy Ghost, overwhelmed with the presence of Jesus. The presence of Jesus. The presence of Jesus. The presence of Jesus. The sweet presence of the Lord. The sweet presence of the Lord. Something wrong with your leg? Nothing? You good? You look good, actually. Just wanted to check and make sure. Getting everything healed here tonight. The sweet presence of the Lord. Mama na 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 say. It's high time for a change, man. Joseph, let the Spirit of the Lord fill you with His same compassion. Joseph, let the Spirit of the Lord fill you with the same understanding. Joseph. Do it Papa's way, not your way now. Now. Now, Father, I ask you in Jesus' name. Let the floodlight of heaven shine upon this life, O God, so that Joseph may be able in every way to conform himself to those things that you want, that you purposed.
you haven't come yet and worshiped the Lord with giving, just come. Find a bunch of people around you, hug them, tell them that you love them. You may consider yourself dismissed. You can stay as long as you want. Never be dismissed. Just a change of the order. I just feel like sitting down in the presence of the Lord here with my hands lifted up. Nakara niya katiya.